start, according to our agenda, we're going to start tonight's meeting with starting our public hearing for notice of intent 270-0675-364 Lowell Street. That is now being reopened and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Massachusetts Wetlands Protection Act, the Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40 as amended, and the Reading General Bylaws, Section 7.1. The hearing will be conducted as follows. The applicant will present information. The commission will receive reports from its administrator, technical advisors, and other town departments. The commission will address questions and comments to the applicant. The public will then be given the opportunity to ask questions of the applicant, which should be directed to the chair. Please give your name and address, excuse me, before your comments and/or questions are presented. There's an attendance sheet. Thank you for signing in. If you haven't already, please take your opportunity to do that at the door. And at this point, would the Conservation Commission please introduce themselves, starting with Chuck.
Chuck Tarone, Conservation Administrator.
Michael Flynn.
Anika Scanlon, Vice Chair.
Harry Curtis.
Al Couliard.
David Pinnett.
Okay, and representatives for the project.
Good evening. I'm Bill Manuel from Wetlands and Land Management. The applicant, David Jameson, is here. And Mr. Crowley, William Crowley, is the counsel for the project. Chuck, did you want to fire the screen up?
Sure thing.
So we were here, I don't know, probably a couple of months ago now, and at the last meeting, we told you that we kind of recapped where we were in responding to your request for additional information. We had a site walk just prior to that meeting. I think that went very well. And really, you only asked for a few minor details on the plan with respect to signage. We had to figure out the final fee for the project. I've submitted that information to Chuck, and I'm waiting for confirmation on the final fee, and then, you know, before the project is concluded, Mr. Jameson will remit the amount due. And we also addressed your tree policy. That was a subject of discussion, and so we've provided mitigation for your tree policy. And then we had another meeting with the planning board, the DRT. We had a DRT meeting, and we continued that our last hearing because we wanted to get to a point where our planning board plans were the same as the Conservation Commission plans. So ultimately, when these both are approved, everybody's working off the same drawings. We believe we are there. We made a submission to planning board and had another meeting last week or so. I have actually seen a draft approval of the subdivision, so I'd like to say that we are on the home stretch of planning board. What I'd like hope to get accomplished tonight, I'd like to think that we're also on the home stretch with Conservation Commission. And again, I would ask at the conclusion of this meeting, we don't want to close this out tonight, but hopefully we get to a point where you feel comfortable to turn Chuck loose on drafting an order of conditions, and maybe perhaps we come back at the next meeting, we have a draft order to review, and we close it out and move towards approval. That's my hope. Let's see how the meeting unfolds. Chuck, if you could go to sheets. Let's start out with sheet C2, which should be the next sheet. So we did we had a tree survey, and what I did is I went through and did an inventory of all the trees in the buffer zone that are 6 inches or greater that were going to be lost, and I tallied those up down here. Is there a way to make that better in focus?
Probably not more in focus, but I can bring it in.
Okay. Yeah, so it's really touchy. Just a little bit further down. I'm trying to get to that table.
Okay.
And so the conclusion was there were 85 trees in the buffer zone that were being removed. And your tree mitigation policy has a formula. If you replace a tree with a 3-inch caliper tree, actually your policy says 2.5-inch caliper. We've agreed at the DRT meeting we provide a 3-inch caliper tree. You can do a 1-to-1 ratio. If you you can replace one tree with two shrubs that are 5 to 6 feet tall, or replace one tree with three smaller shrubs, 3 feet tall. So we have a combination of those, and it all depends where they're going on in the project site. So if we could jump perhaps to sheet C4. That's C4 right there. So we have, first of all, we have street trees that are going in, and those are going to be the 3-inch caliper, and they'll be the 1-to-1 trees. You asked us to have some variety in the wetland restoration area, and so we added a large number of shrubs using like a 3-to-1 ratio. You asked us to put some vegetation in between the mitigation area and the road, and we have a number of taller shrubs in there that are in the 2-to-1 category. And the neighbors expressed concern about having a tree buffer along their respective property line. And so we have a mix of pine and hemlock, which are evergreen species, along the property boundary through here. And those are the 5 to 6 foot tall pine and hemlock. And those are fast growers, and they'll grow probably about a foot a year. So in very short time, there'll be a pretty significant screen there. And that's in addition to all those trees that are remaining. These circles here are trees that are remaining. So we believe that addresses the tree mitigation policy. The things that you asked for included, we put a post and rail fence along the 25-foot zone of natural vegetation. And we also have environmental signs that are in three locations on this lot. We also are going to post environmental signs along at the back of each of the properties where we found leaf debris and paths going out there to, you know, indicates that people might want to use that back side of the property for a dumping area. So we're going to post signage there. There's actually a detail of the sign. If there was an example of the sign I gave to you in the packet, and it's actually right on the plan, just a little bit in the lower left corner of this sheet, I believe. Mm-hmm. Yep. You asked for that, so we provided it. And so, you know, it says environmental, protected habitat area, no leaf debris, or yard debris, et cetera. I forget the exact wording, but there it is. We also clarified the methodology that we're going to use for each of our sort of our mitigation tasks. A lot of it was self-explanatory, but remember there was a T-structure diverter at the outlet of Lowell Street. That's pretty self-explanatory. There was a pile of, if we could back out of that, Chuck, and yep, perfect. There's a pile of sediment here. Really, with respect to this water course here, I just want to be clear that we never had any intention of dredging that or putting a machine in there. It was always, you know, using hand tools, trying to clean this out. It obviously hasn't been maintained in decades. So, you know, once we pull out all this knotweed and this historic fill, we would like to get through there, clean the sediment area out. We're going to walk through and pick the trash, the bottle, the plastic bottles, and things that have accumulated in there. And we were going to use rakes or chainsaws or shovels to hand clear any debris, logs, etc. that we encounter through the water course here. When we were on the site walk with the chair, she suggested, well, why don't you make your life easier and maybe you can use some machinery to at least walk up the edge of the wetlands and reach in to the extent you can to remove any larger stuff. We're fine with that approach. We also talked about, well, maybe we'll use a skid steer. I had suggested initially that we'll put, to get to these leaf piles here, this would happen before we dug this area out, so we'd be able to come right through the uplands, and we would, either put plywood down and use wheelbarrows or buckets so we don't, scar up the wetlands. If we can, we're going to coordinate very closely with Mr. Tyrone. We're going to try to do this in a dry season. And if we can, maybe we will get a mini excavator or a skid steer, but all of that will be cleared through Chuck before any effort is undertaken there. So I think with the documentation we provided, I think the term means and methods was asked of us, and we just want to be clear that this is not a dredging, this is not a straightening, this is a routine maintenance of it. It's a pretty low gradient water course anyway. There are very small spot grades all down this channel here, and I think around here you have about 188.1. The inlet of this culvert is 186.7, I think. So you're barely over a foot of drop between here and here. So even if you got in there and made it 8 feet wide and 6 feet deep, the controlling structures are still right here, and the culvert that goes under the railroad track. So again, it's not our intention to dredge. We're just trying to clean it out, make it as efficient as possible. I think the best thing that's going to work here in terms of water flow and efficiency is going to be removal of this pinch point right here. And anybody who went out on the sidewalk, you saw where that soil material virtually came up right to the back property line and really created maybe a 2 foot wide channel there, and the rest of this wetland that you can see is anywhere 20 feet wide, 30 feet wide in location. So I think that's going to be the biggest bang for the buck right there. I've updated the waiver request because we decided at the last meeting that this feature would require a waiver, and this detention basin feature is considered a structure. So we've added wording into the waiver request to cover that as well. And I believe that covers everything that you asked for. And that's pretty much what the planning board has in front of them as well.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. At this point, anybody on conservation have any additional questions on this notice of intent?
Just a couple of clarifications. For the knotweeds being removed, is that going to be lowered? Is that, when you talk about the pinch point, is that going to be, the grade going to be changed there?
Yes.
That's going to widen the course.
Yes, well, that's actually going to become a wetland replication area.
Okay.
So we're going to grade that to the grade of the adjacent wetland.
And then the sand and sediment at the corner, which you're going to remove.
Right.
At the outflow from Wall Street. Is that the only sand? It doesn't run through the course of the water.
That is the only area. It's like a large delta there.
Yeah.
And that is... there is, you can see there is fine silt a good ways down that channel, but you can't recover it.
So that's really the only section.
Okay.
Right. And then the only other question I had is, and you got it in the photograph there, that corner of stone and concrete in the corner, the pipe comes out, you're going to put the tee on that. What's underneath? I mean, it looks like a bear den under there. Is that...
That might be a shadow. Are you talking this little thing?
Yeah, I thought it was like a hole in there. Is it open to that?
It's a wall. That might be a shadow. Let me see if I can get a better look at it.
You mean in this
corner?
That's
just water.
Yeah.
I think that's just shadow.
Shadow.
You're asking if there's an under drain or a...
Yeah, because I thought that's where the water came out. No.
See this?
No, the pipe comes out right there.
Right.
And then it's sort of superimposed what the T would be.
Yeah, that makes sense.
And
yeah.
So that's just a, darkened area here.
Okay. All right, that was it. Thank you.
It's a healthy cutter. Questions from anybody else on conservation at this point?
Bill, I think you've done a good job. I guess my question
Go ahead.
Chuck, are we, I know we, this was included in the packet.
Right.
Have you had a chance to review the fee calculation, or has this been settled, or is this somewhat, something that's still open, or?
No, it is settled, it's not, and I just feel like the way that was put together is, you know, within that margin of.
What we think is right.
Yeah, what we think it should have been.
Okay.
So it's fine.
Chuck, if you don't, I have a variety of questions, and I, forgive me for not being here in December, there's some family health issues, but.
I have some questions too, but I don't want to jump on your questions, so.
Why don't I go first then? Okay. All right, where do I begin? Let's see, why don't I start with just how I have it on the plan? So on Plan C1, there's a table E1, of existing wetland resource area impacts. And in it, it lists the two wetland areas that are going to be impacted. Areas of fill and dumping, which I assume are all along the property limit, especially to the southeast.
Mm-hmm.
Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay, so I'm just trying to get a sense of where these numbers, what areas these numbers come from. And then roadway siltation, I assume that's the polygon near the outfall of Lowell Street.
Yes.
Okay, so thankfully, because of your good surveying, you're able to quantify the aerial extent. But I'm wondering, you know, when you go out there and you start, I'm not so concerned about the brush piles behind the abutting properties. I'm a little bit, because I think it's going to become obvious where the bottom of those piles is, just visually. I'm slightly more unsure how you're going to determine how far to dig in the area near the outfall. You know, you're going in there, you're going to go remove that sediment. I'm in favor of that. It will increase the capacity, the storage capacity of that area. You know, sediments from surface water runoff typically do contain higher amounts of pollutants. So I'd like to see those pollutant associated sediments taken out of the watershed. That'll improve the health of it. So I guess I'm just concerned with, I know it's a detail point on an already very detailed plan, but if we don't hash out, you know, where, how far do you dig, you know? Do you want to take a guess of like how many feet or more than a foot is your best guess, or you know, I'm trying to get a sense of this.
It's, first of all, we talked about in the DRT meeting that I assume when we get down to writing the order of conditions that we were going to work very closely with Chuck, and he was going to have a lot of oversight, as much as he wanted, when we get down to these mitigation tasks. So he will be there to say, yes, we've done enough, or can you go a little bit deeper? But I think what you will see, this is a very different texture and a very different color material. It's basically road sand that has run off and been deposited in the stream. And I think you will be able to tell fairly easily when we've got the road sand taken out and we've hit the substrate of the stream. Not to mention, there will be an area up gradient and down gradient that do not have this accumulation of material. So it's just like with a leaf pile. You're going to have to judge when you got to the bottom of it. If we're creating a hole in the stream bed, then we're too far. We're really just matching grades left and right.
But if I were to push you a little bit on this and say no more than some number, what would you guess?
I don't think it's more than a foot. It's been a while since I've seen it, but I don't think it's more than a foot of accumulation.
You don't expect to see more than a foot. I mean, I right. just wanted to get,
yep.
you know, a professional opinion about this.
Right. I don't think it's more than a foot.
Okay. That, in my opinion, that kind of helps the process in the future to have that expectation.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so everybody walking into this situation during construction understands what's going to happen.
Right.
Yeah. So, and that helps you guys as well. So that was one question I had on the first picture. As I was reading through the mitigation plans, I kept getting confused as to which clogged culvert to the south of the site was going to be cleaned. Is it one of them? Is it both of them? Is it? Because I think during a previous meeting there was some discussion of getting approval from MBTA to clean out the one that goes under the tracks. But I know there is a second one that's closer to the properties. And
that's right.
And that, it appears like you will be cleaning that one out. But again, like you were saying, if they're both not cleaned out, the stoppage is still happening.
Right. There are two culverts. One of them is here. Here's Locust over here. One of them is here, and we believe this is controlled by Reading DPW.
Which one?
This one?
That one?
And then it flows, there's the inlet to the culvert, the stone culvert that goes under the MBTA.
Okay.
Now, we talked about this in the DRT meeting. We obviously do not have control or access to work on that, and the best we can do is contact the MBTA and have them maintain their culvert.
Oh, it was my understanding that call was going to happen and we were going to get that answer at this meeting.
That's what the process will be. When we get ready to do it, we're going to have MBTA come down and clean their culvert. But the process will be the phone call and come down and clean your culvert. And this will be just a matter of working with the DPW to get that cleaned out, have it cleaned out of the silt that's in there, and put that inlet protector on. And I believe there's some, we're going to put the inlet protector on there.
Just devil's advocate, what if MBTA doesn't come down and clean out that culvert? I mean, is there a plan B?
No, it won't have a dramatic effect. The inlets or the inverts are right here. You can see this is actually kind of going uphill a little bit. This is 186.85. The outlet is a little higher.
Yeah.
It's 187.5. And then this is 187.7, we'll call it, 187.68.
Right. It's going to be driven by the water level, whatever it is.
Yeah. It's an 18 by 32 inch culvert, so it's 32 inches high. So the worst that happens is water backs up a tenth before it overflows the obstruction. It would be nice if we get that down so that everything was flowing downhill from this point. And right now the MBTA would be the critical link there. But it's only a couple of tenths off.
Okay. All right. There's another thing I noticed on the plan, and perhaps this isn't an issue because I think it... the outfall near Lowell Street, it looks, according to the plan survey, like the actual outfall is not on the Jameson property.
It's probably in the street layout.
If you go to the, on each of the plans, the A1 dot, Chuck, I don't know, can you please just...
You want C1? What do you?
That's a good plan. Do you see the little? Yeah. So if you zoom in to the area where the Lowell Street outfalls.
Okay.
and just kind of zoom in as much as you can to that area. I know I needed magnifying glass for some of these plans. I like saving paper, but there's a downside when I'm trying to review the plans.
There's a fine line to that.
So it looks like the boulder walls are off property.
Yeah, they're in the Lowell Street layout.
Oh, okay. So that belongs to the town?
The town, yep.
Oh, okay. Is that... All right, so that's not private. That's part of Plymouth? Oh, okay. As you turn down Plymouth Road.
It's part of Lowell Street.
I wish I could remember the project. No, I do. There's a little bit of a... There's a sidewalk and then a vegetated area and then the wall, right?
Yes.
On that side?
Mm-hmm.
All right. The tree summaries, so those 85 trees, those were within the 100 feet, right?
Correct.
Okay. I was glad to see the breakdown of the replacement of those. Besides the table, is there something I would like to see, or either see in writing or see on a plan, just a little bit more information of where those are going to go? You did part of that with the trees being kept as a buffer.
Now, if you refer to the wetland and buffer zone mitigation plan.
So that would be...
I have amended that planting schedule to include the mitigation trees. And there's a description of each area with the numbers that go in each area, species and size.
So, forgive me, just point out to me where the 12 trees between the mitigation area and the road are shown or are indicated on the plan.
Just scroll over a little bit. They would be.
That was the one.
Yeah. What? You didn't specifically call it out because the plan's getting really busy in here.
Yeah,
that's
it is.
Where they're going.
Okay.
Right in there.
All right. Okay.
I think. The narrative
Okay. Okay. So C3, I'm going to try and go through this as quickly as I can. That slope in that mitigation, that new wetland area, I measured something on the order of a drop of 2 feet for three. 2 vertical feet over three, which is pretty close to 1:1.
In what location?
Between 189, between the cul-de-sac and the wetland replication area.
You're talking right
the
in
wetland
here?
Restoration. Yeah.
Yeah, I think there's a wall that's going in there.
It's proposed wall.
Yep.
Proposed wall, and the design, the schematic for that is on...
If they have a specific detail on the Conservation Commission plans
for
that wall.
How big is that wall? Like 2 feet? Four or more? I'm just trying to get it. Because there's going to be that wall. I'm trying to picture this. There's a wall and then there's additional plantings. You know what I'm saying? That's a really tight spot in the design process.
Yeah. about a 4.5-foot wall, just along this section right here.
Does that continue along the retention farms?
No, it doesn't need to. It's
so
just
that,
is really right,
a natural grade.
Right through here, that's correct.
So it really is, okay, so it's that gray strip? I think that thin gray
yeah.
strip in there is going to be the 4-foot wall?
Yeah, the wall is barely indicated as a line there.
Right.
So that's where it's going.
Right.
And that's the only way you can do it because you're lowering the grade where the knotweed is.
Yeah.
Well, that and we're trying to minimize any disturbance there. Yeah.
Okay, so. So the construction of that wall, that will probably be, is that going to be submitted later as part of, you know, the building?
If that specific wall requires a building permit, there will be plans submitted. I'm not sure that a 4.5-foot wall requires a building permit.
Okay. All right.
The wall we built out of stone, I've not been built before.
I'm just checking to see if I have a detail. We didn't get into that detail on these Conservation Commission plans. Do you have any recollection whether that was going to be a modular block wall or core concrete? Yeah, it's either going to be modular block or core concrete.
In terms of the signage, it's just my opinion, and I'd like to hear what other members think of this. My opinion, I think the signage along the eastern property limits, that's across the river and on...
And through the woods.
Through the woods, on that bottom line there.
Mm-hmm.
I think one sign per abutting lot is sufficient. I don't know if there's...
Yep, and that's what we have.
Is that what you have?
Yep. We have one for this pile, which is corresponding to this lot, this pile for this lot, this... no pile here, they get a prize. And
yay.
One for this lot, and one for this lot.
Okay. All right. Am I done? I don't know yet. Hold on. So it also looks like on lot 2, it looks like the signs are going to be put up at the 25-foot line.
Correct.
Okay.
Along with that post and rail fence.
Okay. All right, Chuck, I've wrapped up. That's about it.
February 8th, I sent a memo to Julie Mincier, Community Development Director, and had a bunch of items. I only saw a handful being addressed when the supplement came in, and so I need to go over a few. And so I know that when I asked for a organic soil mix, you did have that. I wasn't sure if you are going to monitor the mitigation area at a rate of 80% survival, like I asked, or are you going to keep it at 70%?
What I specified in the monitoring schedule was that the regulatory standard is at the end of 2 growing seasons, we have 75% coverage with wetland plant species. I also specified that at the end of each growing season, each of the first 2 growing seasons, we would need a minimum of 80% survival of the nursery stock plants. So if we don't have 80% survival, then we're going to replace the nursery stock plants to get at least the 80%.
Okay. On sheet C4, which I'm not going to be able to move this around and talk, but on sheet 4, underneath the culvert, it says that it's blocked. And I understand that the culvert for the MBTA track has been identified as being blocked, and you have to contact them, and you can't do the work. But any material in front of it, would you be moving that material out of the way if there was, and I believe there's a tree that's down there?
It's off our property. We're going to have to get permission from MBTA to go ahead and do that. They're responsible to maintain the culverts, and I've generally found them to be responsive. I know Mr. Berry, the engineer, he didn't think they were as responsive, but you know, they generally have a real estate team that you call them and say, listen, I've got a problem, and they send someone out and take a look at it.
In your wetland and buffer zone mitigation, you don't name the Conservation Commission as final approval on the work. I was wondering if that could be added to it.
I thought we should discuss that because, I tried to have goals and what a final, what sort of a numerical value of achieving compliance with the restoration area. I just didn't want to get locked into just having one person say, you got to keep going until I feel like you're done. So there's got to be some sort of, want to work with you, but we need to have some kind of goal. Like we need to either achieve matching the adjacent grades, or just like a sort of an open-ended, heavy-handed thing until you say we're done.
I think that's exactly where the commission is.
Yeah, I think that's why you get a commission for multiple people on the commission to all kind of look at it. And Chuck certainly, when we're out in the field or if something comes up, Chuck certainly answer, can get out there quickly and review things. But I think what Chuck said and what you were looking for is exactly what the commission can assist with. I would be of the opinion that we want to include that the commission has that say.
Yeah. Well, you can come up with wording, and that sounds like an order of conditions.
I decide
when we're done.
I don't want to write an order of conditions describing your project. And I think we've been going back and forth on this. We need a starting point of how far are you going, where the work's being done, and then how can we review it? Because my fear is that we have a conceptual agreement. We're locked into where the historic fill is. But outside of that, I don't know exactly what's going on. And when you said it's just me being heavy-handed saying pull it out, I feel that you're the guy that's going to be in charge also. So it's going to be you and me butting heads. I don't want that to happen. And I would rather be looking at an agreement that spells out what happens between Lowell Street and the culvert and what you're going to take out and what you're not going to take out. And as long as this commission's clear with it, I would feel happy to enforce it.
Well, in terms, I feel like the plan is very clear. We've identified distinct areas that we're going to remove soil. And we've actually even, this area of sedimentation up by Lowell Street, we've actually surveyed at the time the limits of the soil removal that was going to happen. We hatched in this area the extent of the mitigation area. I think the only thing, and I tried to be as clear as I could on this, when you say between the culvert, Lowell Street and the culvert, our intention is to remove natural debris. We can go through and take a pass and say, what do you think about this? But, I don't think that it's any more complicated than that. It's just an effort to maintain something that has not been maintained in decades. With respect to the mitigation, the knotweed area, it's got final grades. An as-built plan is going to show you that we achieved it with respect to these leaf areas, all we do is we dig down until we match final grade. I mean, it would be unusual that anybody who put that leaf debris there actually dug a hole first and did it. They usually just pile it on the ground, so you just...
Well, I think we've established that pulling out the leaf is probably something that we'll understand where the base is. But some of the things that I'm talking about is on page 3, where the historic fill, so this is page 3 of the wetland and buffer zone mitigation. So you're going to stake out the limits of the mitigation area in Japanese knotweed and designate for its removal. And then if anything is beyond this area, what are you just going to, you're going to cut and dab at that point with herbicides. And two things there. I think that's where I would ask you, why aren't you pulling more out? That cut and dab method is a 2 to 3 season method with a licensed applicator. And there's no, in this plan, there's no mention of having a licensed applicator on site and or your SWIP plan. So those were some of the details that I was looking for to put in this plan. And then you have the schedule and the objectives. Meet with the contractor and establish timing, the objectives and methods, and re-establish the wetland flags as necessary. So that's not very precise. It's not detailed. It doesn't mention contact the conservation office and set up a meeting to establish the objectives and methods of the removal. So there's another... more descriptive, objective than what you have.
So,
those things all could. I mean, what are we talking about? It was like 2 weeks or something like that. All those things could have been changed. I mean, I had my list, 2 pages right here. Some of the things might have just been you could answer verbally, but others, I was wondering. We got from Thad at a DRT meeting that MBTA. You don't even bother calling them. They'll never clean it. You seem more positive about it. I mean, we would like an effort to be made about that MBTA culvert. If it's blocked, I don't think I saw anything in there blocking it. I saw something blocking it just before it. I asked that the
You're
erosion
right. We look
control...
through the culvert. We can see daylight through the culvert. It's not
It's pretty
big.
Deal. Yeah.
Not a big deal.
It's just what was in front of it, in my opinion, that was the problem. I asked that the erosion control be turned from silt mulch sock to hay bale and silt fence. I didn't see that change made.
Well, again, that's it. You know, a lot of these, Chuck, I thought were appropriate to have a discussion with the commission. Mm-hmm. You also submitted your list before you received the revised packet. So... Some
right.
of those things that you asked for were already included in the material that I was waiting to submit. So, if we could take this opportunity...
Yeah, but that's not in the revised packet. That,
which ones do you feel need... If we can go down... I think I have that list with me, but if we want to go down that list and be very specific, because I didn't see anything in there that was insurmountable. I thought some of those needed discussion.
I think the language granting the permission to the Conservation Commissioner or the Conservation Agent needs to be put in there. That's bullet number 1-6. And then to spell out the goals.
That's the trouble with these hearings.
How the applicant intends to remove the blockage in the drain or channel between Wall Street and Aldred.
Well, I don't know how more specific I can be because that's in the wetland and buffer zone mitigation plan. It tells you we're going to either go up to the edge with a machine and pull it out if we can, or we're going to use hand tools. And I'm very clear that it doesn't include dredging, incising, straightening. It's to remove natural accumulation of debris.
Well,
I didn't
see a goal. The goal is like we intend to have an unobstructed flow between Lowell Street and the culvert on the ambient, so then you could get into your methods of doing it. So then I could, then with something like that, I could say.
If you want me to state my goal to have an unobstructed flow, that's fine. But I've given you my methods. I don't know how
no, I
can be any more clear than that.
I agree. I agree, you said the methods. There's another one that I think both me and Ryan sent to you, and this was before we got the revised plan. We both asked that the construction entrance be increased to the size and width of the entire entrance of this site. And you're on the, in the SWIP plan, you're using lot 3, lot 4 as your storage area. So I asked, I don't know if Ryan did, to extend the construction entrance to lot 4. I didn't get a reply on that.
Is it necessary?
It's certainly necessary to have the construction entrance across the entire entrance.
Well, you only need a tracking pad. This is for the tracking pad is really for exiting the site.
Hmm.
It's not for entering the site.
Well, if you and me were driving the trucks, I would agree that no one else is going to go anywhere except where you're supposed to. But since, you know, we're relying on others, you might as well do the whole entrance.
You know, that could be a condition. You know,
yep.
What we're trying to do is avoid these small little plan changes that can be handled with a condition. And that way it avoids us having to have a resubmission to planning board, and then, you know, there comes this ping pong back and forth. We're very, very close with both boards. That's something, increase the tracking pad for the width of the roadway. That's a condition.
I see this process here as a little bit of a hashing out so that we can get to an order of conditions.
Yep.
Because otherwise it happens at the order of conditions, and if it's a deal breaker for yourself or your client, then you need to know that.
I don't think anything tonight could be a deal breaker. We're all very, very close here. So we're just trying to avoid just multiple plans, because I'm sure you realize, you know, it's not just one plan that you submit. You need to resubmit an entire set. And we're just trying to stop that, you know, back and forth when there can easily be a condition. Increase the tracking pad to the full width of the roadway to lot 4.
You want to keep going, Chuck? Is there any other major?
You know, I really feel strongly that all of these should be addressed or in the plans or in this, in some document from the applicant. So
you have to tell me which ones you feel I've omitted, because there are many of these.
So then
we're going to
just continue.
I think we just need to continue down the list. I would like to make sure we hash them all out.
Things that we'd hash out and things that should be in the plan, I think we just talked about the construction entrance. I wouldn't have expected that that could just be my opinion, but that's okay with me. How often it's cleaned, that's an item for the order of conditions. I have that in here, we'll skip that. It doesn't show anywhere on the plans where you're going to install
there
this.
There is very specific language in the O&M plan about the construction entrance. When it's clean, refreshing it with stone.
It did mention that. I think that you've got some comments from engineering where it's only 6 inches and it's only 20 feet. We're asking for 40 feet. We're asking for a foot. I think Ryan's going to handle that part. So we'll just leave it up to Ryan and to you to discuss, and I'll put it in the order of conditions. Okay, so they show where the semi-pervious straw bale sediment barrier is located on the plan. It seems like a very important thing to have on the plan, and I didn't understand where you were putting that.
Where was that referenced?
It's referenced a couple of times where it's part of your, if I had to find it now, it might be hard, but I think it was part of your sequencing for how you would remove the historic fill.
To put an in-stream sediment.
This is what they. This is what the applicant said he was going to do to block the stream. I assume. sediment, the semi-pervious straw bale barrier. There's actually a detail somewhere showing.
Yeah, the details on C5.
Right.
And it is not intended specifically for working in the stream. I think that's more of a sort of a standard SWIP detail. And it talks about if you have an area where you're getting shallow concentrated flow, that's a way to deal with it by putting a straw bales with a rock spillway in the middle of it, so it sort of breaks up flow and creates a diversion, or not a diversion, but a settling area behind it.
I guess when I was reading through how it was installed, like it said, cut into the bank, cut into the roots, these roots grow quickly and it won't be a problem. I was just imagining that it was going into the bank of the swale or stream.
I think it's a standard SWIP detail. I just want to go back on the erosion control, straw bale and silt fence versus silt sock, and I have a question why. Most commissions are getting away from the use of bales and silt fence because it's so difficult to install versus the silt sock. It's blown in, bark mulch, and it's very heavy, it's very resistant to weathering, and it doesn't bring in any invasive species and weeds.
So some of it is, 8, 12, 20 inches tall. Which one are you getting?
I think you spec the 9-inch diameter one.
So we're...
And that's based on the soil conditions.
You're out there with loaders, you're out there with skidders. I'm just naming a few things. Yep. I might not know a piece of equipment. That's not a barrier. So straw bale and silt fence is a barrier. They'll know when they hit that. It'll prevent them from going into the sensitive areas. Now, I agree, there's a lot, I don't expect you to have it up around Dustin Road, but certainly around the sensitive areas and along, lot one, whatever the lot is that's next to the, that extends out towards the back, I would expect it in that area. So it acts as a barrier, a limit of work, and if someone runs into it, it's noticeable. Where a mulch sock, when you run that over, you can just straighten it out. You don't really, it doesn't prevent you from actually running over it. Someone would do that as part of their daily activity. So that's why we don't do that.
I guess, David and his company will be the site contractors. They've done plenty of jobs like this. I don't expect that they're going to be, if that's the limit of work, I don't expect that they're going to be intentionally violating that limit of work. But to have straw bales and silt fence as your limit of work demarcation, that's a pretty expensive limit of work demarcation. If we wanted to use erosion control, let's put the appropriate erosion control down. If we need to put up caution tape or something as our limit of work, the stuff is, we're not throwing nickels around.
You want to use caution tape to prevent machinery to break through that line?
If a machine is going to accidentally back up and go over the erosion control, it's going to happen whether there's a straw bale or silt fence. But just saying that if you're going to use redundant erosion control to establish your limit of work, that's pretty expensive.
It's pretty much it's a standard. Some are doing it. I can tell you in the three towns I've worked for, Arlington, Boxford, and here, they don't do it. They didn't do it before I got here, and we're not doing it now on big projects. What do we have here? Four lots? I mean, we're just wasting time even talking about this. But this is a major project. You're probably going to clear the whole thing all at once. It's four houses. They're all over $1 million. I mean, we're talking about pennies. This is the standard practice here.
It's fine. If it's your standard practice, it's fine.
I would agree with Chuck. You know, I think there's merit to what you say, and it is something that's changing, but it's standard practice here, and I think this fits for this job.
Let me emphasize on big projects. On small projects, straw wattle, we use that. We even say none. So when it's practical.
So you've suggested the silt sock is appropriate in some areas, but you want to see it in others. Is that a pre-con meeting sort of item?
No, the way the order is written, I have control over what erosions go out there, so you and me can meet out there and decide what you're getting and where it's going.
Okay. That's an order of conditions then.
The SWIP, we're on the SWIP plan where it says implementation, who's in charge of erosion control, you're letting people know, but you're not letting the conservation office know who you're assigning to watch and maintain the erosion control. So that was just a suggested add the conservation office.
I believe in the erosion and or the operations and maintenance plan, again, there's specific language about who is going to be implementing the SWIP, and there is a construction sequence that includes notifying the Conservation Commission, posting the sign, notifying the commission, installing the erosion control. You can add a special condition, I think you already do, that you notify the commission in writing who is going to be responsible charge of the project. So that sounds like an order of conditions thing.
There's no washout area on the plan, although you do mention it in the SWIP.
Concrete washout, yeah. That we have a detail on the plan for concrete washout. It consists of...
Where's it going? That's... I saw the detail. I was wondering if it's on the plan and if it's outside the 100.
And you can put that as an order of conditions. It typically is outside the 100-foot buffer zone. Doesn't make any sense to put it in the buffer zone. And that could be a pre-construction specification as well. Where are you going to put your washout? There's a lot of these things, as we talked about in the DRT meeting, you just can't specify sitting in this room where's the best place for the concrete washout. As soon as you say it, the contractor's going to get in there and say that's right where I need to put the transformer box or something like that. So typically you find a place that's out of the way, outside the buffer zone.
Can we just condition the outside of
the buffer zone? Yeah, we can. It's not left vague. It's always on the plans. These plans don't have... So typically you would have a construction entrance, a stockpile area shown on the plan, washout areas. That's just, you know, the ABCs of what the commission asks for. I'm going to request that the dumpsters be covered at night. I didn't see it in the SWIP plan. You're going to say that's an order of conditions. Overnight parking 100 feet away. Then these reports from the SWIP plan and the inspections, I wanted to email the conservation office weekly. So it sounded like in the SWIP plan that you were doing, you were checking erosion control. We want to be part of those, that paperwork that's generated from your plan.
And that last one, actually, the O&M plan does recommend not applying fertilizers. There's actually a little brochure that the engineer had created for the homeowners, for the individual homeowners. It's the last page of the O&M plan. It talks about why.
Well, it must say it somewhere, because I was grabbing that off, reading through. It must be in something. I'll identify that. We don't have to go through that tonight.
Yeah, so O&M plan.
I think one might be saying one thing, and
there's a nice little trifold brochure.
That's all I had. And if I find that, I'll let you know what page it's on.
All right. It sounds to me that there were enough little items that it just added up to the need to work this out here tonight. So I know it's...
Let's do it.
So are there any additional questions from the commission? Further questions? No. Any questions from the public for 364 Lowell Street? Or from the applicant? No more questions? Yes, can you please give your name and...
Anna Nolte, I live on Plymouth Road.
Yep.
At the last meeting, you talked about that if all of the trees that were cut down were not replaced, money was put into a tree fund. Am I understanding that correctly?
Is that the case?
There's an option within the tree policy that includes donation to the Shade Tree Fund.
And is that being done in this case with these plans?
Currently, the proposal, as I've seen it, has a full replacement. There's 85 being removed, and what's considered 85 equivalent replacements. It, you know, on paper, comes out to more than 85, but based on size, there's some that are 3-to-1 ratio that they're replacing, some are 2-to-1 ratio, but it's what's considered, in accordance with our tree policy, a full replacement of 85.
So to clarify, I did count it up. So 85 trees cut down, but 68 trees planted and 105 shrubs planted as compensation for those 85.
So there are 85 trees going right along that pole
spread out throughout the 100-foot buffer zone. So the 100... There's a lot of lines on this plan.
So we're at the full, we're going to get the lights and the noise from Old Street and everything on our side, on Plymouth Road.
Okay, remind me, Plymouth is to the southeast?
The south?
So the sun is to the south and shines across Plymouth Street onto this property.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
so
we're concerned about the lights from the property itself.
Okay, like the street lights were on the street.
Lights, noise from all of those trees buffer us from the noise from Old Street. We're also concerned about the water because those trees soak up a ton of water, and as we've stated in previous meetings, the opposite side of Dustin, some of those people have issues with water. Us along that land, we do not. And our concern is that now we will.
I hear you.
A shrub is not a giant tree. I mean, it's not the same.
Right.
I think to pretend it's the same or to pretend it's that we're somehow buffered is a false narrative.
So they are requesting to take down those trees for the sake of putting in these houses in that cul-de-sac. And according to the laws that are written on the book, and according to the laws that we have to enforce, we cannot deny them specifically the right to cut those trees for this project. But our compensation plan, like the tree replacement policy, is our desire to sort of balance that carbon budget and the water budget on this also. Those purple areas on the plan are areas, all those shapes, I think this is right, Mr. Manuel, are all areas where surface water is getting put into a container or basin where it's going to infiltrate through the grass or through the soil.
I understand, but at the first go around with this, when there was a different conservation board, you yourself brought up concerns about the water because you said those are not as effective as the actual trees that are on the property, and so we still have concerns.
Yeah, I mean, from a personal standpoint, for me personally, I don't want to see any more trees cut in town. If I had the right to deny a project because of how strongly I feel about let's not cut any more trees, I probably wouldn't approve any project.
But
they are within their rights to do this, and they have shown through their reports and their analysis of the water that they are going to adequately manage or even better the drainage and the water management on that property. And they've done that with extensive calculations, and they're also going to do some dredging, you know, and...
What's that like?
Whoa, we're not doing dredging.
Sorry, thank you. I'm sorry, wrong word. Forgive me. But do selective cleaning out. They're making the wetlands bigger, which is going to, if you think about it, if no water was added to the system and they make that wetlands between your row of houses and their property bigger, you know, it makes more space, so the water levels, in theory, if no new water is added, should kind of drop because there's more room for the same amount of water. You know, the earth doesn't always work that way, you know, because there's rainstorms and there's high water season and there's low water season and there's uptake from the plant, so it's pretty complex. But they are taking steps to make the water system better, and it's and it passes our technical review and our town engineer's review.
And I have another question, and I'm asking this respectfully. I asked it at the last meeting and it wasn't answered. The first time this was brought before the Conservation Commission, almost every member was different. And at least half of the commission had major concerns about the size of the project, and especially that house back there. And they were repeatedly asked to come back with a plan that had a smaller development, and that never happened. So I'm wondering why this commission hasn't brought up any of those concerns and hasn't questioned or pushed back on the number of houses. And that hasn't been answered. And I think as homeowners who haven't, many people have stories of dealing with the commission and haven't been allowed to alter their homes at all, individual homeowners, and because this was considered such a fragile ecosystem, and now we look and we see this giant project put on what is really a very small area of land, and we have concerns, and we're just seeking clarification because it doesn't, we're confused what changed.
So I can't speak to what was previously proposed. I wasn't on the commission. I don't know what was proposed. I can only go off of what's
this
here.
Is
what
this was.
I mean, I it wasn't brought in front of me. I can only go off what they bring in front of the commission now. And, you know, I'm of the opinion that what's currently being presented is an improvement to this system, an improvement to the water system that's going back there. They've shown that they're meeting the technical capabilities. They're providing mitigation for a system really that doesn't appear to be flowing very well right now. It doesn't appear to be maintained. It's filled. It's had years of it looks to be issues. So, you know, I can only go off of what this is.
We haven't had issues. So those of us who live there haven't had issues. And from our perspective, this isn't an improvement. This is destroying two neighborhoods. I mean, it's the character of the neighborhood, it's, like I said, the water, the sound from Wall Street, the lights. I mean, it's, we feel like it's an attack on our neighborhood, and it doesn't feel good, and we get people talking about, well, as soon as my kids are out of school, I'm selling my house and leaving.
That's the difference between what you see as the neighborhood and what I'm looking at as protection of the wetlands.
You call that protection of the wetlands? Tearing it all up and building four houses?
They're improving the system.
That's not improving anything, though. The people that live in any of those streets around there.
Mm-hmm. Or the animals that live back there.
I think the residents would agree that there's nobody's asked for any improvement. It's fine as it is. And what's happening here is a disruption that is unwelcome.
So it's the applicant has a right to do things on their property, and they need to show that they're meeting the intent of the regulations. And, you know, again, I'm of the opinion that they're showing that currently.
Any other comments from conservation at this point? No?
One thing I would say is they just mimic what Mike says. You know, if the shoe was on the other foot, and I would wonder whether you would feel the same way. If you owned that property and you wanted to build on that, would you say, well, I'm not going to do it because of, you know, what's around me? But, you know,
yeah,
I think that they have the ability, they have the right and the ability to do what they're doing. within the current regulations and laws, and I believe that if they own that property and they want to develop that property as such, they should be allowed to do so.
So the way this is laid out, as I see it, there's four houses, one's existing, they're adding a garage, and if a homeowner came in and said, I need to add a garage, and we've changed our regulations since I think that the people at the end of Plymouth Road came in here. I don't know who those people are, but I know that I've seen a permit for them. We would allow it because the garage is necessary. And
they've pushed it as close as they can to the street. They've moved the street over, trying to get it even further away. So that seems to be off the table. And at the last meeting, and I was the conservation agent at that point, that house that exists with the garage was just a hair from being approved, okay? So they only needed to ask, and that would have been accepted, because there was nothing else they could do with it. So a house without a garage doesn't make any sense. The two houses opposite that on the other side of the road, they're outside the buffer zone. They're not even part of what we can even tell them what to do about. The drainage is in the buffer zone, so we're talking a lot about drainage. And the street has to be a cul-de-sac. The fire department tells you how large the circumference of the circle needs to be to get one of their trucks through it. So those things are all part of a checklist that has to happen. The road, we approved 60-foot wide road layouts. This is a lot less than that because the town worked with this applicant because they wanted to reduce the amount of road and reduce the pavement. It's a cost savings from them. It's a benefit for a low-impact development. Conservation likes it. Planning likes it. So when we move through everything here, we're looking at one house, and that house is on lot two.
And why is it necessary? That's what we don't understand. Why the push for that house?
So let's focus on lot two for a second with that one house. As you can see, it's pushed as far as it can be away from the wetland. There's a line up there that gives it a setback. It can't go any further. I do believe that house was shaped differently when it first came in here. There was a house here, but it wasn't shaped like that. I mean, that's not ideal. I mean, you enter through the garage and then run into the... I mean, to me, to someone that's been doing this a little bit of time, it looks like this applicant worked to get this thing to fit in this area. One of the regulations is that we protect the 35-foot zone. And closer than 35 foot, you're not allowed to build. This house is, except for two or three spots, is outside the 35 foot zone. And to accommodate for that, that's why we're into trying to solve this flooding problem or this drainage problem. So most applicants don't do this much work. This is almost two projects, working on the drainage and building the houses. So the town is getting a little bit for it. So what I see is one house outside the 35-foot zone where we let most everybody build a house if it's up to the commission. I'm just giving generally, if there's nowhere else to put it. And this house is pushed all the way to the edge, outside of the 35-foot zone for the most part. They're using low-impact development and planting a bunch of trees. They, you know, our tree policy is brand new. Most big developments are able to meet our requirements for the tree policy with plants and shrubs. So this area that's beyond the fence in that lot two is going to be protected. That's where we feel like it needs the most protection in that area. So the owner of that house is going to have to understand all that. That's going to be in the order of conditions. They're going to have to sign something saying that they understand that no building can get any closer. Now, as far as those trees being removed, they're on these gentlemen's property. And we have a replacement policy allowing people to take trees down. And they were able to meet that policy. So we can't change a policy midstream. I mean, we could look at it in a couple of years and see if it's working or if it's not working, but that's kind of my assessment or rundown of what I'm seeing. It's when you look at where our offsets are, our jurisdictional setbacks, the water quality stuff is closer to the wetland, is doing the most infringement on the 35-foot zone, and all the hard surfaces and houses are further back. So I don't know if that helps or answers your question. I just maybe it helps you know where I'm at.
Yeah, I disagree with it.
Any other questions or comments from the public? Can you please state your name and address?
Pat O'Brien, 27 Plymouth Road.
Thank you.
And is there any provision for if there's homeowners in those homes that they can't cut down the trees that are planted or the shrubs that are planted? Is that going to be built into provisions?
Yes, that's come up in previous hearings, and it's kind of become part of our boilerplate standard order of conditions. That additional trees.
It's not that they can't cut them down, it's they can't do it by right. They have to come back to the commission, prove there's an issue, and then usually an arborist is involved.
Yeah.
And if they say the tree's diseased, they have to apply to cut it down. They'd have to to use the tree policy and go from there. So it's true that we write something in there that any tree remaining can't be cut down by right, but there is a process to have a tree cut down for health and safety, or if it's diseased, that you can go through with this commission.
Okay, any more questions?
Sure, just to add to that, that's for items that are in the buffer zone.
Right.
Within our jurisdictional area.
Yeah.
Yes.
Janine O'Brien, 27 Plymouth.
Thank you.
I was just curious, I understand about the Conservation Commission, you're going within the letter of the law. How many waivers have been granted for this project?
How many waivers have been granted for this project? Like a variance?
Variances.
Mm-hmm. I think there's one variance application, is that correct? I think for the whole project, they request one general variance that breaks down the issues, you know, per area.
So they need a variance for this spot right here. Can everyone see that?
I don't know if I'm
going to see your mouse,
Jeff. Yeah. Oh, this spot right here, it's a sidewalk that extends over the 35-foot line. To the extent that a sidewalk is a structure, and typically your 10-foot setback from the zone of natural vegetation is so that you don't cut roots or do soil compaction of trees that are in the 25-foot zone. But there's a small incursion of sidewalk here. The roadway cul-de-sac is in this section right in here. It's really unavoidable. We had to get a waiver for this wetland mitigation feature, and again a waiver for commission has decided that is a structure, so we needed to get a waiver for this work in the 25 to 35, and we needed a waiver for this grading that is in the and the portion of the structure in the between the 25 and 35.
And where that garage is built was an existing driveway.
That's correct.
So that is impervious, and it's looked on as already built in some form. So to build back on top of it, no net loss. So the house that exists with the garage and the driveway is defendable because there's less encroachment into new areas. So you saw how minuscule the encroachments were in the 35-foot zone. Those are what they asked for a variance.
Any further questions on this project?
I have a question. Melissa Russell, 23 Plymouth.
Thank
I'd like
you.
To know more about the wetlands mitigation. This is going to be in my backyard.
Which?
Right at the cul-de-sac, right there.
Right there?
Yeah.
So it's my understanding that that area of the lot right now is basically fill material. So, you know, buried debris, lawn debris. I don't know exactly what it is. Mixture of dirt and brush, maybe some trash. But it's basically an area where it's clearly been filled. And what that shape shows right now is that that's going to get excavated out, and it's going to be turned back into wetland.
So I'm not sure as to what does that mean to be turned back into wetland.
So today that's a very constricted area, so that's one of the places where it's hard for water to get from point A to point B. So by leveling that area of what is today a slope of historic fill, dirt and other things, which is probably why it's full of knotweed, because somebody did an excavation, dug up some knotweed and threw it there, and now it's spread in that area. So by creating, by cutting that historic fill out and replacing it with wetland plants at a grade that allows water to flow through there when water's higher, it's actually going to allow the water to move a lot faster out of the area and over towards the back of the lot and out the culverts that will be cleaned out. So what all of this is doing is actually improving the flow of water from north to south, getting it out of there faster, and doing it in a way that ensures that the water comes out the other side clean.
Does that help?
What that meant.
Yeah, it basically means there's going to be more wetlands in that area instead of a side slope.
Can I have one more question?
Can I
get a little more information about the 4.5 foot wall?
Is it
visible?
What is it,
and what's its purpose?
So the top of that circle, the roundabout there, that's going to be higher than the wetland. And it's going to, they can't make a finished ground surface that will hold vegetation and be stable between the edge of that pavement and the wetland. Do you know what I mean? So they would either have an extremely steep slope of soil that would not stay vegetated because it's too steep. Okay, so what they're doing instead is they're going to put a wall in. So we're talking, our best estimate at this point is a 4 foot plus or minus.
So about this high.
Wall. To stabilize the road and keep the road base supported, and to also be a barrier between there and the wetland.
Mr. Manuel, what kind of plants are you planning to put in that area?
And he's putting 12 trees between the wetland and that street.
Along the whole back?
No, 12 trees only between the wetland replication area, that new constructed wetland, and the road. 12 trees only in that small strip there.
But are they also going to take care of that whole wetlands? I know they're going to go through and rake it, but after that, what are we going to be left with? Are just, you know, little shrubs, or are they going to come through and put more of a barrier for us?
So that's what I just asked.
So to answer your question, we're going to put a mix of red maple trees and white pine. And that would be in this area here. In terms of what happens in this wetland, there is no vegetation that's going to be removed. It's just removing debris within the water course.
So therefore you're not planting anything?
Well, there's nothing being removed that needs to be replaced.
Okay, yeah, two more,
and then we got to move on because we got other.
The 4 foot wall, which I'm 5'4", is probably this high. Are we talking that wall is going to be sunk in, or are you talking 4 feet from the ground surface? You know what I mean? Like, say this was the surface, is it 4 feet high, or is it 4 feet, including where it's sunken into the ground? Are you burying part of this wall, or is it just 4 feet high? Because that's not 4 feet high, that's about 3 feet.
We don't have a specific engineering schematic for this wall, so that's why I can't, can you answer that?
Well, a retaining wall has to be, has to have a foundation, some of it will be in the ground, but as best as I can calculate here tonight, it's about 4 feet of exposure. But you won't see this very well because we're putting a mix of white pine and red maple trees in front of that wall.
Okay. Yes?
Colin McKinnon, 10 Plymouth.
Thank you.
Isn't there a rule that if a lot abuts wetlands or within 100 yards, there has to be maybe only 15% of the lot is covered by structures or driveways? And is this in compliance with that rule?
I think you might be thinking of the Aquifer Protection District.
That's not this?
I'm just guessing that
yeah.
That might be what you're thinking about. So there's different areas in town where there's an impervious cover limit, and that's with an aquifer protection district area.
I live on the opposite side, and I was told by a previous person at his job, I think, that no more than 15% of my lot could be impervious, I think. And
your property might be part or all of it on the aquifer protection district. So that's...
But this may not be included, this side?
Right, because the aquifer protection district is basically an area, another shape drawn on a map somewhere that literally tries to protect a drinking water supply. Okay, so...
Dill, is this, do you guys know... I thought that we did talk about this before, whether some of this property is in the aquifer.
It is, and on page C3, there are the appropriate aquifer protection district recharge calculations.
Yeah. So the way the bylaw works is, you guys can help me if I don't get this right, you get 15% or 2,500 square feet, anything over that, you need to recharge for the difference. So it doesn't stop you anymore. They only need to recharge over what they were, what they're allowed.
What's the recharge?
Is it 1-to-1 or what do you just have to recharge all the impervious over the 2,500 square feet? Is that per lot? Or
yes.
It's per lot.
The calculations are per lot.
Yeah. So you can take whichever number is greater, and then you have to recharge the difference. So, I'm assuming that you wanted to kind of say, if they don't meet it, they have to reduce the size. That's been changed. So they only have to recharge.
Not reduce.
Right.
Okay. All right, is there, at this point, I'd entertain a motion from someone on conservation here.
So I think there were a lot of things on truck.
Yeah, I think we're going to recap.
Yeah, I want to try to do a recap
yep.
here, just to make sure everybody's on the same page. Whoops.
Well, I plan to recap by video through our CTV, because I think there was a lot that we can't... You know, if we recap, we can recap the major points, but we won't get everything.
I didn't think there was all that much. I think a lot of it was addressed, and there was several that we agreed would be in the order.
This is a man of the plan. Let's let him recap.
I would like to not have him leave here without having like a
Go
list
ahead.
Of like this is what we think are on here. I mean, I don't think I have everything. That's why I want him to recap as well. So,
yeah.
Chuck, you've got. All right.
So can we start from the top?
Yeah, go right ahead.
And we'll do this very quickly. The first one, no plan spelling out goals, how the applicant intends to remove the blockage in the drainage channel. I did revise the buffer zone mitigation plan to show the means and methods, and I think we're pretty clear on that. If you want to just, it's a couple of paragraphs.
I think we have to go over that, so that's where we are with that one. That one needs more detail. So it's the means and methods of how they're going to clean out the blockage. This is the big, so we'll talk about that.
You talking now?
No.
Okay. I gave you the organic soil mix, second bullet item.
Yeah.
I gave you the spec about 80% survivability, third item.
There is a note on the plan about the species of trees in my mitigation plan. We discussed that we will call the MBTA and have them clean out the culvert. Beyond that, there's nothing more we can do.
You won't, so you're going to not do any work off the property? So, that being said?
We can't.
Okay.
Yep. The language granting the Conservation Commission final approval, I assume you're going to put that language in the order of conditions. How do you want to handle that?
That's fine with me.
The licensed applicator for the herbicide treatment, that's a standard condition in many towns. Would you like to put that in the order of conditions?
Yeah.
I guess we're fine with the silt fence and your suggestion on the erosion control. We're fine with that. That can be an order of conditions. Same thing with the construction entrance. To specify it's going to go the full width of the roadway to lot 4. Stockpile area, do you want to wait to the pre-con meeting and have the contractor figure the best area? Or specify it's going to be outside buffer zone?
We can do that in the order of conditions.
I think we can specify it's going to be outside 100 foot.
Again, how often, I think the SWIP, the O&M plan is pretty specific about, you know, when it gets clean, refreshing the stone. Do we need any more information on that?
No, I think that that can be looked at by whoever's in charge of the erosion control and make the call.
Okay, so OC, you'll have some kind of clarification?
Yeah.
Okay. So we talked that semi-pervious straw bale is probably a standard detail for a SWIP plan. So
that's really not being used anyway.
Right. So that's kind of NA. This SWIP or the O&M plan does talk about who is responsible for implementation during construction and post-construction, and even calls out the homeowners responsible for portions of it, and the town of Reading, who's eventually going to take over the roadway, is going to be responsible for other portions of it. So, is that sufficient? The O&M plan is already specific about who's in charge pre-construction. It'd be Jameson Development, or not pre-construction, but during construction. And it's also very specific and has O&M protocol for each homeowner in their little LID, the rain garden, and their infiltration areas. And then it also calls out what the town of Reading would have to do, or what Jameson Development would continue to do the maintenance until the town accepted the road and
So I can't put everything in the order of conditions. Some things have to be, you know, when we get through this, is it all going to be in the order of conditions? I know there's like two that we didn't say was going to be the order, but the O&M plan, I would prefer that gets modified. Are you going to be able to modify some of this stuff or just add addendum?
I'm just telling you what's there, and do you need more details than that?
Oh, I could show you one that's very detailed. I would prefer that it is more detailed.
Then I would have to ask you what information is missing.
Yeah. I'll send you the really good O&M plan, and you can look at that, and maybe you can call me and say it's not needed or not.
I'd rather know what information from this O&M plan is missing.
Okay, so
I don't want to reinvent a wheel because
I don't have it in front of me.
It's several pages. Operations and maintenance, this is the O&M plan. It starts out with a statement of intent, project identification. It tells who the applicant is, who is the design team, what documents are referenced in this O&M plan. It has a construction sequence. The first thing is a SWIP implementation. Talks about contractor shall locate material stockpile area. Now the construction entrance, specific details about that.
So that's so, that one you just read? Contractor should locate the stockpile area outside the 100-foot buffer zone. It's detailed like that. I'll find it throughout that thing. So you can keep reading if you want, but I could work with you outside of this meeting.
Why don't we do that? Just for the sake of moving
on? I thought we had, on that one, I thought we had agreed it's going to be outside the buffer zone and that would be a condition.
But okay. I think Chuck's saying he doesn't want to put all that in the conditions.
I think I'm in agreement with Chuck that there's, it's good to have things in the condition, but order of condition, but at the end of the day, the person's going to review the O&M plan. And it'd be nice to have a lot of this in there and detailed out in that document.
Maybe an addendum added to the O&M plan? Don't have to.
However, it's time. That's not.
Just as long as the information that.
I just want to be handed material, not modify material that comes in.
Yeah.
Okay, the second page. Again, concrete washouts in the outside buffer zone. We'll put that in the O&M plan. You know, if we. I guess I'm fine. Modifying the O&M plan, it's the plans at this point. I mean, how many times could we have to go back and forth?
I don't think we have a lot of major issues.
Right.
I haven't heard many major issues about the actual drawings and schematics themselves.
Right.
So I think a lot of the rest of this can be covered.
Is the O&M plan being reviewed by any other commission or department?
It was reviewed by engineering.
And engineering.
All of the drainage. The O&M plan is always part of the drainage package.
Yeah, okay. Well, I'd like to move on, so.
I'll go quickly. Again, the vehicle washout area, that's sort of the, that's the I guess that's dealing with concrete because you wouldn't have to wash out a vehicle for any other reason. So it's going to be outside buffer zone. Zone of construction inside each lot area not marked out. We have the limit of work marked out but indicated by the erosion controls. I don't know if there's any other detail that I can provide to be more specific.
No, it's just called out in the SWIP plan, so I just figured you'd have it on the plans.
And it is indicated by where the erosion control is going. No storage. Is that on the planning board plans? We talked about we're just going to push it to the end of the cul-de-sac and plow it to the side of the streets.
Yeah.
So the snow storage is on the set of plans that the planning board has. Do you need
okay.
any other information than that?
Can you just send us that copy?
Show the fence on lot two. We've done the
yeah.
fence. Proposed decks and patios. There is no proposed deck or patio on lot two because that is really tight. We just don't have the space for it. Lots three and four, any deck or patio is going to be outside of the buffer zone. The entire house is out, so whatever they decide later on, it's going to be outside the buffer. Can infiltration pond have more labyrinth low flow channel? The answer is no because of the way it's designed. It is designed to inundate that basin. There is no sort of flow through that channel. It's just going to fill up till it reaches an elevation, then enters a catch basin grate, which then distributes the water subsurface. So there is, okay. Add Daily Lowell Street, that's no problem. We'll do the O&M plan. Oh, same thing on solid waste, cover the dumpster, we'll put that in the O&M. Overnight parking, O&M plan. And we'll be specific that the CONCOM gets the daily reports. Typically those are emailed. Construction sequence point to C7. the constriction, or is that construction, Chuck, on the second to last bullet item?
I
think it's construction.
It's construction.
The construction sequence point to C7, with details on knotweed management. This could not be, I'm not sure what you're asking for there.
I think that you answered that. You should talk about where the knotweed is, and that gets back to whether we're getting a detail or a more detailed description of how you're going to take care of any blockage in the stream channel. So what I was saying is you're going to mark off a certain amount, which I brought up in this meeting, and then anything outside of that, you're just going to cut and dab. And I didn't see the follow-up for invasives. That would be a 3-year follow-up to make sure that they're gone. You don't need to do that. If we address this in a different way, which is you dig out those areas too. So I don't know what you're going to come back with the sequencing, but that's where the detail was.
Yeah, I have a suspicion that we will probably grub those areas and just get rid of it.
We'd like to see it out of
there. Did you have one? Is that pretty much it?
Yes.
I think that's pretty much it. It's just also applying fertilizers.
Yeah, I'm going to have to find that. It's
PMPs
and two different information somewhere. I couldn't find.
So that, if that can make it into the O&M plan.
I believe it's there, though. Find it, point it out for you.
Okay. And I'll entertain a motion to continue the hearing.
Make a motion to continue the hearing.
March 8th. Second, no. All those in favor?
Okay. Are we sort of moving in the direction of drafting an order of conditions?
I envision that at this point. Is there any other discussion among conservation about that?
Chuck can work out the details.
Yeah, I think I would like to work out the details and then start drafting, but I can do some of it.
I think Chuck has an idea of what needs to get put together. I think there's details that
okay.
We need to get cleared up, and that, you know, certainly if he starts to get things quickly.
Yep, and we'll look for an addendum to the O&M, an addendum letter.
We're going
to
go as far, I'll get this as far as I can go, you know, and work with Bill.
Okay.
And try to have something ready.
Yeah.
So that's the
right.
goal.
Well, if it's ready to go, we'll be ready to go. Okay.
Thank you. It was very
thank
productive
you.
Tonight.
Thank you everyone for coming out. Thank you, public, for coming out, giving us your comments. All right, so we're going to move on to the next hearing. I should open this one.
This one is it?
This is 1260. Yeah.
Yep.
So, okay, so I'm going to the public hearing for notice of intent 270-0680. That's 1260 to 1264 Main Street, map 45, lot 104 and 106, Mass Equity Investments LLC. Is now reopened to being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Massachusetts Wetlands Protection Act, Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended, and the Reading General Bylaws, Section 7.1. The applicant will discuss the proposal. The commission will receive reports from its administrator, applicant advisors, and other town departments. Commission will ask questions of the applicant. And the public will be given an opportunity to ask questions of the applicant, which should be directed to the chair. Please sign in at the entrance if you haven't already. And before asking a question, please give your name and address before your comments and or questions are presented. And we will now introduce ourselves, starting with Mr. Panette.
David Panette.
Al Couliard.
Harry Curtis.
Anika Scanlon, Vice Chair.
Michael Flynn.
Chuck Tarone, Conservation Administrator.
Thanks. And just for the record, could I just have a show of hands of members of the public who are here specifically for this project? I just wanted to get a sense. Thank you. Okay, go ahead.
Okay, thanks. For the record, my name is John Tellman, Women's Surprises in the game. And so tonight, we were on the agenda tonight. We actually ended up bumping the sidewalk to the stone, really cut the out there. So we moved it ahead, we shared that. But I did want to take this opportunity tonight to bring the revised plans. I don't expect you to look at them tonight, but I want to bring them in. I have a cover letter to look with them about allowing the changes. The changes we made were based on commission's comments last week. CBDC comments, and also I think during the final comments. So we were working on the boards and commissions on the plans. So we revised the plans that happened tonight. I was presenting them to you. I present you with the cover letter outlining the 21 changes. It says what they are, what the final on the plan. I also have it was asked by the chairman last week in regards to the Section 2 of the data form. It was one part was incorrect. I had that by, so. So I have the plans here, so I'm going to pass them out.
Sure.
I don't know if you want me to go through the list of changes or you wanted to.
If you could just highlight the most important ones,
okay.
The major ones.
Yep.
So this is the.
This is 11 by 17.
So are they substantial enough that I can recycle this?
Recycle.
All right.
Like I said, I don't expect you to go through this. This is just a.
Yeah.
We make it easier when we're at.
Right. So I just figured I'd clean it off tonight instead of. I have two larger plans I can do with you, two sets of original.
Okay, great. Yeah, I'll. Yeah.
Nice. And this is the cover letter outlining revisions. And that, these are just the CDC engineering comments. And so I want to make sure you're aware of other changes we made to plan just other than this submission. So.
If you have extra copies of this plan, if you're interested in offering them to the public.
Okay. This is just the.
One
copy of that?
Well, that'll need to go back to the chair.
Okay.
So, and in our file. So, thank you.
I'll go through quickly. There's 20 items here, change of plan. Some this commission is concerned about, but I'll kind of skip through those. In the plans that you have, in item one, we added a landscape plan, which would be sheet 9, which is the very end. That includes 6-inch caliber trees, which is a limited work on the plan, and also a pre-buffer providing or proposing on the left-hand side up here, North Pet Zone. I know it's out of jurisdiction, but we did submit part of that in the landscaping plan. Two is mention of the 6-inch caliber trees. You can find out that on the landscape plan itself. We did trees in the buffer zone and outside the buffer zone. All the trees on the parcel, the two parcels themselves. On that sheet 9 was the landscape plan. We do show the limited work line. We tried to drive it down a bit a lot once. It's kind of outside of the jurisdiction. But we're reducing, we had it front of the back. It's back to here, 3-car garage. Pulled the four, we reduced the impervious area. Number 5, we had a 10-foot no-cat landscape. Again, it's outside jurisdiction, but it's along here. We're proposing 10-foot no-cut existing trees. And some of the bare spots, we're proposing robust juniper in this area here. And I'll be working with the planning board, maybe adding a few more here. Again, outside jurisdiction, proposing additional trees.
I know that's outside our jurisdiction. I'll encourage you to use native species.
Some of the utilities we changed, the forest main, 7 road, that was plus engineering. Number 7, we have test hole data for sheet 2 and 5. That's for the sort of the groundwaters at the town, also in the potential volume areas, infiltration in the front. We do show on sheet 8 the wall locations. Some of the sheet here, but sheet 8 shows a height of wall 3 feet, 4 feet, 2 feet high, along lots 3, 4, and 5. On sheets 4 and 5, we show the proposed E1 pump locations for the front of the house, pump locations here and here, and the same thing here.
So what were those?
The pumps, the sewage pumps. So we show just the clean out area here, but we start showing the pumps now. What do we want?
Takes forever.
There's a note on sheets, on the plan sheets, regarding the trees. Street trees and the layout. I did speak to the tree warden. He said he didn't want to specify the trees at this point. He wants to say, you know, probably will last with the trees there. And at that point, he would decide how many and where they would go based on utilities.
What typically does he call out for
He didn't say the time. I know he went to live in, but he didn't say how the size. So.
Okay.
What he's going to want is, I think, an as-built plan show. So these are, so put the trees not on top of pictures of utilities. On sheet 5, I calculated the impervious area for each lot. And so, between the driveway and the house. So, we know each lot has a impervious number, a budget, I should say, that they can't go over. So, when they come back from those intents, we would show the impervious areas as proposed and planned and make sure it's consistent with the intervals intents for this lot. Say this lot was a house with a bigger driveway. If that occurs over, we'd have to show additional mitigation on the property. And I was concerned because these stormwater potential pond areas are sized based on this plan here.
So can I add, for the two houses, and I apologize, I wasn't at last meeting, so maybe this was something that came up, but for the two houses that are outside the jurisdiction,
right,
that wouldn't come before the commission if the impervious area increases.
That's right.
Is there a way that we're covering for that?
The only thing I could suggest is that an as-built plan would require with the or in this, I mean, system compliance that we show you that these areas outside the buffer zone are budgeted correctly. That's, you know, I can't get in my mind how we're gonna, you know, enforce that with these lots.
Yeah.
And you know, when we submit the planning board plot plans, they should be consistent. But you guys have kind of left out of that circle there. So I think at the end, as part of the condition, and then as we'll plan for the organization, should include the impervious areas for loss. Because the detention pond and infiltration are within your
jurisdiction. Yeah, exactly. So it's still impacting what's in the jurisdiction, even though it's on, you know, a project.
So that was my thought. I don't know if you had anything different or thoughts about.
So interpreting the engineer's speak, the concern is that the houses built end up bigger than planned, the stormwater management system wouldn't be it would be over capacity.
Correct.
Got it.
So, you're proposing to sell these off, or that's possible.
Right.
That what you're proposing, the contractor that comes in has to be within that box, is that true, or square footage?
Well, so these are oversized boxes.
Yeah.
So we budgeted the area, including walkways and decks. So these are 2,500 square feet alone. The houses themselves is about 2,500 square feet first and second floor. So we're anticipating, you know, a box. What was it, 28 by 40.
40.
These are 70 feet, but we did that intentionally, oversized them for walkways, patios, and this is budgeted for this retention. It may be smaller.
So they have to build inside that box?
No, I'm not saying that. Well,
okay.
Square footage.
That's the maximum impervious area.
It's representative.
The ones that are in the buffer zone, if they are looking at square footage and they move them closer, that would be a problem.
Right, I'd say no closer within the jurisdiction. These cannot be closer to what's shown at this point.
Those would still come before us, though, right?
Right, individual, this one for the addition, and this one would come before you individually.
So how does the home buyer know, or how do you control this? Is it something that goes in the deed that says this property cannot have impervious surface greater than X and be within the 35, or how do you?
Well, they could. They just have to provide additional drainage for it. I mean, that's...
Right. Okay. But so how do they, I'm just wondering...
How do they all agree?
How do they know?
Which one gets to get bigger and which one has to get smaller?
Well, I think if this one comes in, the numbers are on sheet five. There's a tabulation there. It says that each lot contributes there. And I'm saying that each lot has to maintain that.
Let me ask it another way. How do we ensure that the conditions that we're agreeing to here survive into the discussion of the individual NOIs on those three houses on the right-hand side?
It comes back to you,
and
we submit this to you, and you should look at your, the first question you ask is, does this meet the budget that's on the original order of conditions? Does there be...
And the original order of conditions is going to be in the deed when the title's transferred to the individual lot. It's transferred.
It will be because it will,
okay, all right, I got it. As long as Chuck can find it.
Both those. So this is one for you.
Okay.
And I think those are 10 one of the questions.
I got it.
You look at the old plan to say, are you meeting the budget?
Okay.
That was both of
So it unfortunately circles back to the original question, right? That there's two outside of the...
So I think in this order of conditions, you'd say as-built plan should require, before sign off on this, such compliance that these meet the impervious area.
Is an as-built too late, though?
Well,
the building department asked for an as-built when the foundation is in,
right.
So we could ask for that also.
Okay.
I mean, you could have issue of compliance and some compliance. So.
But
it's a good question. Something that came to me too.
Yeah,
these are outside.
There's
of it.
Just that there's a vehicle in place that we can, we're going to have some sort of understanding of what's going in there and how it compares to. What's
and my thought is that there's going to be situations where there's no lots that are in the buffer zone designed for certain impervious areas. So how does the town oversee that?
There is a provision, Chuck I'm sure can explain it better than I, where even if something's outside the buffer zone, if it has impact on the wetlands, it still can be jurisdictional.
Okay, right, I remember that.
And so...
If the water... from that area has the potential to impact.
Right, which is exactly what this would be.
Right, right.
Okay.
Still, it's one of those things that doesn't necessarily set off alarms, right?
Right.
That's the more likely than unlikely to cause...
Right, but there was a project down that the town had where they were resurfacing an upper part of a side street and the drainage... and. We had the authority to have them put sediment, so sediment capture devices and BMPs in the catch basins, even though the outfall was like 200-400 feet away. So, go ahead.
Not necessarily something we need to resolve tonight. I just did something.
Right, it's a good point because the team in my head too. So on sheet five, we have the cut and fill volumes as requested by the plan. I don't know if you want to see it, but it's in there. We're trying to balance the site as we could, but we're actually bringing more on the site below the lot. We didn't want to take a lot off the site. It requires more blasting and more trucks in and out. So we 14 was the revised section 2 of the indicators and hydrology.
Yeah.
That form, we submitted that. At the end of lot 5, when we have the driveway, I'm proposing, you see it on sheet 6, here, the infiltration trench at the bottom, so it slopes down this way. And we have detail on detail sheet, I think it's detail sheet six, that shows this is a stone infiltration trench. Chuck has time to review it and see what he thinks about it tonight. I don't expect you to see it tonight, but. So walking that neighborhood would be captured. This was originally a driveway, now we have stone, the pipe is completely backed over. But it's able to capture the water that will come in the other way here. 17th edition Toronto Pond 2 does have 2 feet of ground water separation. It was 1/10 short, we advised the situation would be that 2 feet of cover there. 18 was the language for the evening here. So on sheet 3, notation explains how this works. It's sort of complicated. This parcels, how this gets swapped out. Can you show back to sheet 3 of the other of the plan? So we go to that one. And then sheet 3. So it's a little confusing, yeah, this here, if here gets built out, you have the two parcels here, and two easements, and what happens if they build it through, it doesn't happen. This parcel A would be parcel 2A, and parcel B becomes 3B and 4C, vice versa. And it's explained on the left-hand side here, it's more for the planning board, how that comes into play, if they ever build that out. It also explains here, note down here, about the access easement. You see on the plan? You scoot over this way, check right here. It's a note down here. We talk about the easement remaining in place for trail and access to the abutting property in parking in this area here, to remain in perpetuity. If it's ever built out. So that's that language on the plan. It would also be written as part, submitted as a public covenant, and also written into the deed of how that works to be recorded. So if it's never built out, it remains as an access easement for trail use only, no cutting.
So you're talking about the road, if the road is built out?
Yeah, if it's not built out, then you still have access there for trail only use in parking. 19 was we added utility, gas utility to the per engineering permit. And 20 was the water gate connection for the engineering. Now, I know last time you asked about the Cornell study, and I talked to the engineer to the drainage analysis. He said he did not use the Cornell study. I think that he just did, but we were required. So I don't know. It's part of this commission that you're required me to go back and do the drainage analysis. And,
So what was the design storm used then? What was the
2, 5, 10?
Yeah, I'm sorry. Hold on a second. I'm trying to find it.
It was six inches plus per 100-year storm. Which
2, 10, 25, 100.
I think it's 6.7.
The numbers are all over the place, actually, Mike. We got it closely.
Everything's designed to the height, right?
You got it.
Yeah,
I mean,
he did 10
there, but we can show you that.
Do you mind directing me to the page in the notice of intent where it's.
Yeah,
The reason why I ask and make a little bit of a comment about it is I've seen huge variety. Do I?
I don't know.
Okay, so
have,
I don't have
you
that.
You may not have that full drainage analysis in the notice of intent. I'm going to double check.
We only got two copies of that, so.
I think I got it.
You got it?
I don't think I have it here.
Not everyone runs through that, and we have engineering department.
So their 100 year is 6.5 inch. And I think, have you had any conversations, I mean, I'm trying to have conversations with engineering about it.
He didn't bring it up, he just talked about their requirements for it, and he just, he does each one based on what the town requires, so, and this commission is going to require it, and he said, do it, you need to go back and burn those numbers again, so.
Which, the records, I guess, where's the 6.5 come from?
I don't know where the 6.5 comes
is
from.
Is it referenced in the,
I've heard 6.1, I've heard 6.5, I've heard 7.5, I've heard.
We just saw a project that did 7.1.
7.1, and, you know, every time I get a new stormwater calc, I get a different design storm. And I'm kind of looking at, so my, I'm trying to reach out to engineering, we haven't had a discussion yet, but I'm trying to start some sort of discussion so that, you know, it's the same town.
Right.
It's the same weather. Like, it shouldn't be that wide, it shouldn't be that wide. These design storms have an impact on our drainage infrastructure and our roads,
mm-hmm.
The amount of backup that happens in subdivisions and all sorts of, you know, it's got pretty far-reaching implications. And then, at the same time, we kind of have to be realistic about what we are going to expect.
Right.
We have to have a little bit of reality check. And
yeah,
so I'm not going to, I'm just going to ask the question and raise it. I'm not at a point right now of saying it absolutely has to be this, but I think we all have to be a little bit more careful in our designs that we're.
It's tricky because every town's different, and we consult them and the approach. What will they approve? So that's the kind of approach we take.
Well,
we want to do it this way, and they're like, no. Even though ready-made looks
so. I understand. I'm just saying from a real physical reality, there really is a true 100-year storm in Reading right now. You know?
Yeah.
And it's just a professional to make
that
number. You know? So anyway. Thanks.
I think that was just the 20 items. One thing I did leave off, we're proposing markers.
Right.
To show that. Yeah, I didn't show a fence on top of the wall there, because I wasn't sure what you'd be looking for.
Does it need a fence? Does it
A fence is some kind of deter.
A barrier.
Right.
Cool. Yeah, so that was what I was looking for in that area. If you guys were going to add that, that would be nice.
Yeah.
If I had to pick up drainage, I'm going to put
that's
in trench.
Condition. Yeah. I can show the plan, but I wasn't sure
if this is what we would do. I heard you say post and rail. I don't know if that was. If you do a post and rail fence, are we also going to put the concrete markers in, or are we going to put the signs on the fence?
So we have a 4-inch by 4-inch plaque that says conservation area.
We
usually ask for them to be on granite bounds or concrete bounds,
right.
But we allow them to be other places. But a fence might not be, especially a post and rail fence, it's not going to last forever.
Right.
But the wall may. Yeah. So you have that option.
Okay.
I had a question on the boulder wall. You mentioned 3 to 4 feet, but on here, 3 feet.
On the schematic. On the design.
I think it's probably stock behind right here.
It's
the max would be, I'll revise that.
So
that
makes
that's a big enough difference. Yeah, it is. See, that would require engineering design. So we show on a plan until sheet.
No, I'll go through it.
Plan set.
8 of 9.
Yeah, 8 of 9.
Okay. Stone wall?
Yeah, so 8 feet, yeah. We do show like 1 foot here. That's 2 feet, 4 feet. So the engineer provides. So our height's here,
and there's impacted 0 feet.
So see this here.
Here, and it's 4 feet here, 4 feet. So this is just,
so
I think the saw is along with, and we'll revise it, they'll have it 4 feet high.
Okay.
But these, you know, we brought this, we designed this to get the height, we brought this detail in.
Yeah, so there's not going to be an opportunity to put that plaque on that type of wall.
Right.
So you would, you know, you would do it here. Yeah, bottom wall.
Yeah.
So,
that
would
be it.
And I don't know if our last applicant was going to have signs that said no dumping. If those were proposed, would you adding some helping signs?
Yeah.
Okay, if you've gone over the basic points, is there questions from the public? No? Questions from commission? No? Okay. Hearing none, thank you. We will review them. Something else?
Skip a sidewalk.
You'd like to do that, okay.
Did you want to do a sidewalk?
Yeah, so we had a plan for last Monday, but it snowed, so
well,
is everyone...
it's going to get warmer,
is everyone
so
available to do it this Monday at 11, like it was last Monday?
This Monday at 11, I can.
Or Sunday?
I can do Sunday at 9, normal.
So we're going to go through the same thing. Is everyone, is this... You're going to have to go on your own, and everyone else goes Monday.
I might
going
go.
To show
I might
up.
Go with you on the weekend.
Is everyone still available for Monday if it's at 11 o'clock?
Nita's going Sunday. I'll go Sunday.
I can do both, but I'll go Sunday.
I can't do Monday. I can do Sunday.
What are we doing
not
on
my
Sunday
usual
then?
John, how do you feel? It sounds like more people are going on Sunday this time.
I don't know
predictable
if you realize
crowd.
The conservation regulations, but you are required to bring bagels and coffee.
So this coming Sunday at 9 a.m.?
Okay.
This coming Sunday or the week after?
This Sunday.
Well, I was thinking this Sunday, but it could
Sunday.
Be the week. Be the week after.
Okay, no, it's fine with me.
Let's
just say this Sunday. So fresh in our
don't
minds, everything. Let's do
no,
this
guys,
Sunday.
Don't change the site visit schedule. Do it when the packets come out. It's that Sunday before the meeting.
But we have all this stuff we need.
Every meeting is.
We just got handed everything, so.
I know, but you're going to end up running twice. So.
Okay, let's
up,
go
it's up
at
to
the
you.
Typical
it's up to you guys.
Site visit
you're,
time.
You're the ones
9
doing
a.m.
it.
Take this Sunday off.
I know you're really eager.
Okay.
No.
I think we're going to do it with our typical rotation, which is every 2 weeks.
Okay, so.
Okay, so not this one, I'm sorry. Not this one,
yeah.
But the next, the
okay.
Following.
If you want to go ahead of time, it is staked out.
Oh, it is. So what is staked out? The street
we did the
layout?
East, center of the road.
Okay,
east,
side of the road.
The box of the house is the right hand side of the buffer zone.
Okay.
And the detention pond box.
Okay.
And that he. They put numbers on, they should put like house corner, lot 4.
Yeah.
Like here. This one's existing, so, you know, bumping up here, 4 points here, 4 points here, 4 points there, and then down the road.
Is the wall staked out?
He did, yeah, he did the gear walls,
okay.
A couple spots on the wall. And it'll stay in the state, became the wall.
No,
that'll be a yard area too. And the road actually runs through a little house, you get to walk around the house. That's it.
Three five, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I'm sorry. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Is there a motion to continue?
Motion to continue. MRI for 1260 Main Street.
I'll second.
All those in favor? Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Okay. 21 Hunt Street. The public hearing for 21 Hunt Street, notice of intent 270-0679, map 20, lot 253 and 254 Madden, is now opened and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Massachusetts Wetlands Protection Act. Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40, is amended, and the Reading General Bylaws, Section 7.1. We will receive, the applicant will present their proposal. The commission will receive reports from its administrator, technical advisors, and other town departments. The commission will address questions and comments to the applicant. The public will be given an opportunity to ask questions of the applicant, which should be directed to the chair. Please give your name and address before your comments and/or questions are presented. There's an attendance sheet at the doorway. Please sign if you haven't already, and we will introduce ourselves, starting with Chuck. Starting with Chuck.
Conservation Administrator Chuck Taroni.
Michael Flynn.
Anika Scanlon, Vice Chair.
Mary Curtis. Sal Kulia.
David Clement.
Okay. Mr. Sullivan.
Yes. Thank you. For the record, my name's Jack Sullivan. I'm owner of the Sullivan Engineering Group. I'm here with one of the property owners, Neil Madden, and his wife, Andrea, is co-owner, but she's not here tonight. Basically, what the Maddens are looking to do is to construct a 20 by 30 detached garage on their property. As you can see from the site plan, there's five trees that will be, need to be cut that are within the 100-foot buffer for this project. Some background on this property: there's an existing sewer drainage easement here. At the November town meeting, the town voted to abandon a drain easement that goes through the area where the proposed garage is shown today. At the time of the filing of the plan, the Attorney General's, he has to approve all the approvals at town meeting. And so there's a note on the plan that so far we haven't gotten word back from the Attorney General that I think the town meeting's been approved, but it will go through, and a building permit would not be issued unless that easement is officially abandoned. As you can see, the majority of this site falls within the 100-foot buffer zone to the bordering vegetated wetland over here. As part of your tree policy, I located all the trees 6 inches or greater within the 100-foot buffer zone. A small portion of this property falls within the aquifer protection district. The way the aquifer protection district's worded, even if a portion of the site falls within it, in effect, the whole site qualifies. So what I try to do for this site in order to promote drainage recharge, also to deal with the tree policy that the commission's adopted, I tried to provide a rain garden to capture stormwater runoff. Yeah. This is a detail of the rain garden showing basically from the proposed garage, the roof leaders will discharge into the rain garden. A portion of the existing house will have their roof drains going into this as well. It's just a shallow depression. I have a total of 34 different plantings throughout the rain garden. In order to protect, there's two trees just outside the rain garden area. You can see I have a 2-foot-high boulder wall on this stage. On this area, and that's to protect some of the existing trees that exist. This rain garden will capture the entire 2-year storm event. Larger storm events will overflow through this riprap spillway and go out towards the wetland area. You can go back to the first slide.
Yeah, Jack, can I just ask you a question? Did you, for the five trees that you cut down, did you use any of the plants in the rain garden to for your replacement plants?
Yes.
So all of them are contained in the rain garden?
All of them are contained in the rain garden. So this is the existing driveway here. The existing house is an existing deck. We're burdened by an easement. There's an existing sewer service that goes out here. So I was really pinned into where this detached garage could go. Under zoning, I have to be at least 10 feet from the primary structure. I have to be 10 feet from any lot lines. We met with the engineering department. We were going to look to replace the sewer service, but where it's transite, under DEP now, that's considered a hazardous material. So we decided not to touch that. So I'm a little bit shoehorned in where the garage is going, but it's basically at the edge of the existing driveway. The height of the garage, there's an existing one-car garage under on this house. You can see I have a garage slab elevation of 100.89. I match that with this garage.
So that's going to be a slab?
It's going to be a slab on grade. what will happen is I have a 3-to-1 slope. There's a spot grade of 98 here, 96 here, but there'll be about 3 to 4 feet of foundation showing on this back side of the garage. Right, so he'll have to, it'll be 3 feet, and then he'll have to have 4 feet below that for frost protection. It is allowed by zoning. This is the maximum size you can go with a detached structure. It's a little bit unique. Usually with rain gardens, I typically use those for commercial applications or for subdivisions. I don't usually use them for single family residences, but for this case, and especially with the new tree policy that you guys put in place last fall, it seemed like a good combination where you typically look for drainage mitigation, you're looking for landscape plantings, so this might be something that becomes more and more common. And I designed this based on the soil maps for this area. They show it as a loamy sand. I designed it a sandy loam, which is basically 60 minute per inch perk rate, so it's very conservative in the design approach. And that's about it. We show hay bales and silt fencing to be placed along our limit of work. The proposed garage is just over the 35 feet, so we do meet the 35 foot no structure limitation, and there's no work proposed within 25 feet of the wetland area. So I'll open it up to any questions.
Any questions from Conservation, Dave?
I just had a question. When I was looking at this, and I looked at your, was able to look at the foundation plan, and I was just wondering what you were going to put for material. Like you just said, that you're going to have, you know, a bald foundation behind this. What's going to be at the corners of that to actually hold back? Because it's a fairly steep gradient between the front of the garage and the back of the garage. What's going to be put, like, right behind the rear foundation wall, was that?
There'll be exposed concrete, so that wall will end up acting almost like a retaining wall.
Is there going to be any kind of, you know, silt cloth, stone, or whatever that's right behind the? I understand that the runoff and the roof is going into that rain garden, but you have a pretty steep slope, like in that front between the rain garden and that back corner. We have the 98 there.
Yep.
You know what's going to go with that corner right there?
Right here.
Yes.
Right here. That was going to be grass, a grassed area.
That's going to be just a.
Yep. Yep.
That's going to be.
Everything's a 3-to-1 slope in that area, so you can grass it.
Do you have to do any additional grading in that area?
In this area.
Yeah,
I have a proposed 96 contour here, so that right in this section. So there is some transitional grading that's needed.
So is that what's existing, or is that what you propose and when it's built?
There's a 96 contour running right here, so there's about 2 feet of fill in that section.
Is that the, are you replacing the driveway, or is that?
No, the driveway is as is.
And does it slope towards the garage, or?
Right, there's a spot grade C at 100.5.
Yeah.
So this pitches up to this point. I'm having this pitch to this point, and then it goes up to the street.
Okay.
That's why I tried to match the two slab heights to keep the drainage as is.
I mean, probably realistically, though, if that, the top of the wall to the right of the rain garden is, top of the wall is 98. So really that 98 contour is not necessarily gonna like scooch around that back corner.
Mm.
That 98 contour, realistically speaking, is probably gonna meet with the edge of the wall.
Mm-hmm. Right, so
it'll
be more level in this area. And then we, off this back corner, then we grade off of the 3-to-1, so that's
great. Right. Any other questions from conservation?
No.
Chuck?
No, I have no
questions.
I just have a comment that I want to bring up that I was talking to the applicant, Mrs. Madden, and she told me that this problem at the end of that street with people dumping at the end of the street.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd just like to make a public comment in open meeting that I would like to see perhaps, you know, one of those signs that is going at 364 Lowell Street, to be placed at the end of that, and possibly one of our conservation signs, you know, with the little owl that's at the edge of that, so that, and maybe an official sign put by DPW that says no dumping.
I agree with you. I don't know. So who are you proposing pay for that signage?
I don't think the owl is a really big deal, but I think we'd have to present it to DPW. You know, see about, you know, no dining. I would assume that they have signs that state no dumping.
Is that town land?
Well, I think as well, that's also, that's the bottom of a hill.
Right.
And the pavement ends, but the land continues.
Yes.
So a little bit of that could be washout debris as well, but I'm not negating, but I think there might be a combined effect.
No, what the applicant said to me is that people actually pull up with trucks and they dump their stuff out the end of the road, and police have been called and things like that.
Those neighbors or those landscapers?
I think a little bit of both. And, you know, police have been called, and I think it's just something that I think it wouldn't be bad to, you know, see if something can be done to mitigate that.
Who owns the land?
I think it's conservation land.
It's
the town of Reading conservation land.
It's.
So the best thing to do is to get a picture of the license plate, call the police right away. I mean, that's the best thing to do. The sign is hasn't worked anywhere else. I mean, sometimes it works. There's people that agree with it and other people don't. So we haven't had much luck with just putting signs up. But yeah, if anyone wants to get more active, then we can do something about it.
But there's a sign there. You can't, someone pulls a pickup truck out there and dumps a whole load. They can't say, oh, I didn't know.
That's right.
What fence would fence help?
I don't think so.
Is there a trail there?
You couldn't tell. Yeah, snow on the ground, so I really couldn't tell.
Any trail?
That is actually a trail back there.
Is that the bird sanctuary?
It is.
Okay.
But I think it's all filled in now. Like, really, it goes back probably 300 feet, and that's it. But we do find that people go down there and don't. My wife and myself, we reported, obviously, to the police because
they dump it
on our property, which is our lot that the garage is on. So we're kind of more upset with that, thinking they can get.
So what happens after you call? What's
the? The police do what their job, and they just, you know, they file a report, and they, you know, they handle it accordingly to what they have to do. I think more or less it's a warning, and then people just stop. But it's one of those things, just be a good neighbor, more or less. I mean,
yeah,
we just try to institute that. When people get out of line, you just have to use law enforcement, unfortunately. But yeah, no, I definitely, my wife more so, she would love to have that sign. I know she spoke to you the other day, and she was excited to hear stuff like that. I'm not opposed to paying for the cost of the sign. Obviously, if it's reasonable, whatever, it doesn't matter.
You know what might be easy? Go on to Amazon or something and look for a sign.
Yeah, I'm all for it. Yeah, absolutely. I'm not trying to put the burden on anybody. I just don't want people to, or be responsible for having people ruin my backyard, my side yard, either.
Do we used to have some, like, sitting around or something?
We don't have any dumping signs, but if you don't want anyone hunting back there, we're all set.
Yeah. In all fairness, I think it's more the recourse that we don't want to be seen as we're doing, as we're not.
Right.
And that's what aggravates us. I mean, there's years from where, obviously, we bought the house 2 years ago, so everything that's there, more or less, is just over time.
So I'll look into talking to the DPW
and finding out about a sign
and who owns the land.
Yeah.
I think it's a good idea.
So could they put in like a 4x4 in the corner of their property and then look again, one of those little owl signs? Reading conservation land?
We could do that. Are you proposing any of the granite bounds with this? Yeah, it's down the hill, right?
That's downhill.
So maybe there's no granite bounds proposed with this project because my assumption no one goes down there. Is that true?
They'll go down there and take walks. But the problem is the vegetation is just so taken over that trail that you can't go far.
So do you know what the concrete bounds, we put in these concrete bounds 2 feet in the ground, they can stick up a foot, you know, two feet.
Yeah, no, there's none of those.
You
there.
Think,
I think,
well, I know that. Oh. Do you think if you installed some of those with this project, we usually ask with notices of intent that you would install granite bounds, and on the top we have a plaque that says conservation area. Do you
sure.
think that
I mean,
would be a help in that area, or does no one go past it? That was kind of my question.
Yeah, I mean, I really think if people are going to, they're going to do what they want to do. I mean, you can't control people. I'd like to defer people. People know that obviously that's town property.
It sounds like it is in a wooded area already.
I mean, yeah, unfortunately, you know, you can't control people for the most part. I mean,
you can propose just putting one at the corner.
I think instead of a granite bound, I think something, you know, just one of those signs, you know,
I think if it's stated,
just one sign right at the corner of the property and right at the edge of the town, I think would be.
Yeah, the corner of the property is almost in the 25-foot zone.
Yeah.
Right. I think the biggest concern was also that everybody thought that that was town property where that proposed garage is going. So that everybody thought it had kind of free-for-all there.
Right.
So in essence, I think that upset my wife more than anything, that people just thought they can come on our property that we pay money for to do what they want. But then, furthermore, I think it upset her more that conservation was getting ruined.
Right.
You know, so.
So we're gonna ask you to put one granite bound at the property line, right in the corner.
So you want me to be responsible for it?
Yeah.
Okay.
I have
well,
the sign.
Already.
You just need to
okay,
get the granite bound over concrete, and usually, people, well, Jack will probably know where to
sure.
send you.
Shape concrete. I'll help you with that.
Yeah.
That's one problem.
You already are eyes on the ground right now, which is great.
Yeah. Oh, that's
I dig a hole from that bound, and then I'd include a no dumping sign, right?
Yeah.
Well, we're going to try to take care of the no dumping sign. Put it at the center of the...
I'll put it in the center of the road.
Right in the center
road.
Of the road.
Yeah.
Just find out who owns the property. And I mean, the thing about signs is, like, there's even a song about that. You know, everywhere you look, there's signs. I mean, I don't know if...
I think it's
can't
some,
fill up the world
sometimes
with signs.
Yeah, though, people
sometimes
can't be naive to it.
Right.
So they can't
no,
say that it
no,
is.
I get it. It's tough. I mean,
the hot dumping
so,
app goes in the entire condition.
Overall, though, are there any other comments about the project itself, the proposed rain garden?
It's great.
No?
Looks
okay.
good. Looks good.
Any objections?
Good.
Any questions or comments from the public about this project? No? So, motion to...
I make a motion to close.
Is that a question?
No, it's not a question. That's what...
Second.
21 Hunter Street. 06679.
Okay. Seconded.
Second.
All those in favor? Okay.
Sorry, I missed who seconded it.
No. Okay, and
so you know,
at this point,
jealous about your garage.
Chuck, do you think you could prepare an order
I
for
sure
the next
can.
Meeting?
I sure can. We'll have an order ready for the next meeting.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, our next order of business is Low Meadow.
Jack, you don't need a new. We don't need a new plan, but if you could just show that granite bound on the as-built.
Okay.
Thanks,
Jack.
Yep,
thank
Jeff.
You.
Okay. We're getting to you.
No, I thought you were going to close. Sorry.
I'm sorry?
I thought you were going to close.
No. No, we're here all night long. No. Okay, so our old new business, the Low Meadow order of conditions.
Chuck has
Chuck
an order. I gave you my
comments.
Comments.
I incorporated your comments, and the applicant hasn't seen it, and so most of the day we were going back and forth over how to incorporate the conservation restriction and what they would, what kind of letter they would send to the commission, and I think I sent one out at the very end of the day, and I'm not sure if that's acceptable or not. But everything else seems to be what we asked for. But it was the conservation restriction that was that I didn't know how to incorporate, because I can put the meets and bounds in there from where I think it's going to be, and to, and the building envelope and what they're going to use for construction site. I can go around that with what I think they'll want. At the end of the day, they're going to make a change, so it, it didn't make any sense to put anything in there at all, except to say that you know, the owner is responsible to grant a conservation restriction within 30 days of the owner buying the lot, and I think he's waiting for approval by getting this order of condition. And then it also says that this commission will not approve signing off on the building permit or any other building applications for him to start or allow any work until it's in place, agreed to, and recorded. So,
so you've got no answer about that yet?
I don't have an answer, but I you know, I understand the applicant's argument, which is the owner who owns it now doesn't want to put a conservation restriction on the land until it's bought, because it will diminish the value of the land in,
right,
in her and her attorney's opinion. So she won't allow that. The developer won't buy it until it get, he gets the order of conditions, because he doesn't want to get into this gray area. So neither one of them wants to jump. So we tried to say, offer a letter that was signed by the owner that they would, you know,
the buyer,
they would do
sign
that,
the buyer,
that they would agree to a conservation restriction, and that didn't go anywhere either, because I don't know who the owner is and he wasn't available. So I did talk to Julie Mercier, who's the community development director, and we both agreed that it's a condition of the order of conditions, and it needs to be met before they can move forward. And if the building department, you know, I won't sign off on the building department permit, and she agrees with that. So I'll have her help if needed, but I don't think it will come to that. I think that the building department won't issue a building permit unless conservation is satisfied through its order of conditions.
Meaning they can't start building the house until the conservation restriction is in place.
Right. In place, agreed to, and recorded. So in order for even town council to look at it, I need language and I need a plan that shows the meets and bounds and all the access points.
Chuck, in your experience, how long does that usually take to draft, agree to, record?
Well, it could be done,
conservation
just, it could be done in between meetings. You know, Brad Latham,
okay,
did one for us, changed it all around, and he kept coming back every week with one that was ready to go, and then he got it recorded within a couple of days.
Yeah,
so,
because I when I first joined conservation, I knew of one that really languished.
Well, that was the one. That was the Harold Ave.
Yeah.
And I don't understand what the problem was with that, but, you know,
I think it just fell off at people's radar.
Yeah, and,
is my
and then that's the one that Brad was working on, and we had that fixed pretty quickly.
What do you mean fell off people's radar?
Oh, just whoever was responsible for the next step on the applicant side wasn't taking it to that next step, so it went week after week after week after week.
Yeah, and that's a different conservation restriction that doesn't allow any
right,
access.
Right, this is a lot more different.
Okay.
This is a lot more
urgent.
There's
a sense of urgency.
The second point that the applicant said in that letter, though, this afternoon, which I did have a chance to look at, was they were asking for... they were asking for us to agree to $500 of fee limit for the trees that they're taking down.
I didn't see that as applicable.
That was in the letter.
They misread our policy.
Okay.
Because it's in there, and they're, you know, obviously everyone looks to their own interest, but it's in there that you can either, it's $250 or a maximum amount of $500 for the applicants who are individual homeowners, and then for new subdivisions and commercial uses, the minimum is 250 and the maximum we set.
We set.
So.
So that's still up for.
You read that in a certain way, you wouldn't think contractors were involved because it says commercial, you know, stores and subdivisions, which is more than three lots.
Right, right. So I don't think 500 is a reasonable limit in this situation for the number of trees and the maturity of the trees that are getting taken from this lot.
Did you not understand what I just said?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
No, I didn't.
I'm just was wondering.
I'm just repeating
she's
it.
She's
that's
reiterating
all.
Her point.
In agreement.
She's
okay.
Repeating it.
All right. Okay, no,
So what would be the number?
I feel like we need to change our policy or we have to accept 500. This guy's also given us a conservation restriction, so let's not, you know, get down too deep in the weeds. There's a lot of things coming out of this project that's good. You might want another condition, in my opinion, to say if, you know, we can't even approve this project if the CR doesn't come through, so it doesn't really matter. I was going to say if the CR doesn't come through, you're going to pay for the rest of the trees, but...
I think 500's fine.
I don't think, I mean, the applicants 500
is more than we were getting a year ago, and it's town plants trees.
I'm fine to table the discussion until later, but...
The thing is, they have to come back and accept the condition of receiving the order of conditions. So if they don't accept what you've proposed, then they're not going to get the order of conditions.
No, they'll only we can sign tonight, and they only have to come back. So we can agree on how I laid out how the conservation restriction would happen.
Okay.
We can sign this and approve this as amended. I'll make those changes, and we could issue this.
Okay.
Why wouldn't we?
It's your comfort level. We asked for conservation, I spelled it out. So if you're comfortable, then...
I think it's fine. Do you think it's fine to go with the 500?
This applicant,
that's my
one of the last couple that came through,
it,
all the rest of the applicants did shrubs and plants in the mitigation area. So
right.
These are actual trees that are getting planted.
Yeah.
Right.
So I apologize, I wasn't... What's not getting put back?
So it's 40 trees, and they're planting... No, is it 40? They're planting 25, so it's 15 trees.
But they're planting 25 real trees.
They're planting 25 real trees.
What's
25
real trees?
And we're getting a conservation restriction.
So when I asked Steve about that, he said that that lot, in his opinion, with the shading... couldn't handle any more trees. So it's trees,
Steve,
some of the
Steve
trees...
Steve being the consultant.
Steve...
Erickson.
Erickson, thank you.
Yeah.
Some of the trees are arborvitae.
Okay.
We need a motion, or do we just need to agree?
Well, we have an order of conditions. Yeah.
So we just need to agree.
Did everybody... You want to review the order of conditions? I sent it out to everyone.
Yeah, I looked at it, but can you remind me where your... Did you put the conservation restriction text, a draft text, in there?
I did.
Is that one of the A, additional conditions?
I thought it was one of the things that was written in red.
It was. Yeah. But it's not going to be red in here, so I have to go... The owner should execute a grant... of conservation restrictions to the commission for the land to remain in its natural state on the west portion of the site with bounds as shown, and this is something I have to change, document 2, I was expecting a document, and as described in the findings.
Okay.
I think that's a great way to handle it, no restriction, no permit.
Yep.
Yeah.
It's definitely going to get done.
Yeah, it is. It definitely is.
So then it asks for prior to other work on the site, permanent visible stone or concrete bounds or the equivalent shall be set in place in the ground at turning points to mark the conservation restriction and shall be maintained in perpetuity. Also, no other work on the site can proceed until the conservation restriction is executed and recorded at the Registry of Deeds.
Chuck, is the intent that the concrete bounds go all the way to the end of Arnold Ave?
No, the intent is that it goes all around. All around that, wherever the conservation restriction goes. See, and that was the other
all the way over to Arnold Ave, right? Over to the cul-de-sac and the two parking spaces.
Oh, does it go up to that area?
Yeah.
Yeah.
See, that's the rub on this whole thing. We're asking for a conservation restriction. They, in that letter, they gave us numbers, right? Did you see that?
Square feet, acres, so it's like four.
Yeah, it's like four point
acres,
something acres.
0.08.
But he didn't show me where it would be, so I'm not sure. And the update on that area is that, you know, talking to Julie about this site, she said that Ryan had looked into it with Jack Sullivan, had got back some material, and he was more comfortable with how that was laid out, showing that the property is owned by this applicant. But they haven't made their final decision yet.
You just lost me, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
As
so why are we talking
as
about...
As to what, the 4 point, the exact acreage?
Sorry, we jumped around. At the end of Arnold Ave, there's a piece of property in dispute that apparently was claimed by this applicant. And it was claimed because they used the original road layout, and they got that from the state of Massachusetts to show the property boundaries. But there's other maps out there that show a different layout, and they needed to solve that problem. But that's not a conservation problem, okay?
Okay, it's just a property
issue. But for our purposes, the concrete bounds of the conservation restriction would run along the back of the site, behind the house, and then up and around to Arnold Ave.
Yeah, I would expect them to go just on the property line all the way around as we know it, and then up to the 25-foot ZNV, and then be part of that, and then drop back down again. But I'm not sure about that. They might want just a little bit more that's not in the restriction.
That's fair.
Is that on a plan check? That sounds.
See, I think that's the issue.
No,
it
does not.
I have something here I can show you if you want to show the last plan.
That's a lot of feet. I mean, what are you talking about? 25 feet apart?
It turns.
No, we don't have a set marking for conservation restriction, so it's every 25 feet or at turning points. So you'd have to put something else there too.
I think for the sake of the conservation restriction, if we don't have an actual plan showing what is the conservation restriction area, then how can we?
It comes in the form of a deed, right?
Ultimately. Go forward.
Ultimately, it's got to be a deed, but yeah. Probably.
Well, we can go because we have a condition. They have to meet all the conditions of the order of condition. And the first step is that they execute that conservation restriction.
And we are saying,
where is that
word,
restriction going to be?
Are you saying in word in this order of conditions?
Right,
where
I read it before.
That exactly.
Yeah, and
the
it's
way
also
you describe it.
This,
yeah.
Okay.
The meets just by based on the meets and bounds that we.
Based
here.
On the meets
no,
and bounds.
No. It just
and
that,
the 25-foot zone.
That none of that's in it. It might be in that copy there, but most of that has to get taken out. We don't know where it's going. It's just that they have to execute one, and he's telling us there's going to be 4-point-something acres.
So what if he wants to execute one that's 10 by 10?
He said in his letter that it's
the
going to be
volume.
4 point.
That's got to be 4.92.
Then we don't issue a permit.
Yeah, that's we're going to put that number
in the order
of conditions.
You're holding a building permit,
they're
going to do what you want them to do.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah, it can go any shape he wants, but he's telling us it's going to be about 4 point.
Yeah, I think it's whatever. Fine. I think it's fine. Let's
he said he only needed like 2,100 square feet for the house and the property. That's all he's going to carve out.
I think we should sign it.
Nope.
I'm going to make a motion. I don't think there is a motion.
Yeah. I don't think you need
the order.
Do anyone want to look over the order of conditions?
So I have a question. I did we have kind of an open-ended statement here saying they don't meet the tree policy, and no other correction for that?
Well, that's what we're doing tonight. That's why I have to address those issues. And
Jack's going to say they meet the tree policy because they're going to
yeah.
be $500.
I mean, either they actually didn't meet the tree policy on what we thought it said, but when you actually read the text, you know, it seems clear that they're not a commercial site or a subdivision, so they can...
It's always up to the discretion. Isn't it always up to the
yeah.
discretion?
Only if they jump to that next level.
That the
it's not,
it is, and I think
it's not. It's not. Because you have to get to the next level. It's up to the discretion. When you're a subdivision or for commercial use, it's up to the... Here, read it.
I thought we had
second
that one blanket statement that everything is always up to the discretion.
No, at the end, I didn't get to that. Yeah, maybe.
Well, I read it as the right here where it says the maximum amount of $500 for applicants who are individual homeowners, which is not what we have at this point.
So, you,
but
you,
we don't. We
you think they're following a gray. This is falling in a gray area.
Usually, when it's in
you
a
know,
gray
so
area, we side with the applicant because I've seen the commission do that many times. I know what we intended to do. It simply doesn't say it.
I think you can read it both ways, to be honest with you.
Yeah, it's true. Well, I actually, you can't read it unless you're...
What do you think is a... are you proposing another
I'm
number?
I'm not proposing. I just thought, well, how much does it cost? What were we saying was a cost per tree? Didn't we put that in?
$250
a tree. So right now, instead of, like, getting the credit for, you know, what they're missing, 15 trees... And they're giving us credit for two. You know, and I just saw that as a little bit uneven.
But you can't change the rules midstream.
It says, however, the commission...
Well, no, it's up to our discretion to implement the policy and the $500...
Here's how I read it.
Okay. Yeah,
the $500 limit was for the individual homeowner.
Because if it says it on that last
yeah,
line of the second paragraph...
It says, upon mutual agreement of commission and applicant, when the appropriate replacement ratio cannot be achieved on site, a voluntary contribution deposited into Redding's shade tree fund may be made in lieu of replacement of one or more trees. These funds will be used for tree planting transplant. However, the commission may at its sole discretion apply a different standard when conditions warrant.
I think that statement covers it all.
Voluntary
no matter what
trade,
next
shade tree fund contributions will be a minimum of $250 and a maximum of $500 for applicants who are individual homeowners. For new subdivisions and commercial uses, the minimum will be $250. The maximum will be set at the commission's sole discretion.
So we're trading those trees for 4,100 square feet of conservation restriction.
Well, I'm just
the way I see it.
No, 4 acres.
4.1 acres.
4 acres. I mean, you can look at it that way. I'm just trying to treat the trees as an isolated standalone.
Yeah.
Yeah. Not look at the conservation restriction.
The
because yeah. we're still like losing 15 old growth trees.
I understand
you know?
That, but
so
it still
I'm
says in there that if you're an individual, it's a maximum of $500.
Right. Is that
what this is one house, one individual. It's not a subdivision. So I don't see how you can exercise anything more
well,
than the two trees of
yeah,
$500.
Yeah. No,
we typically would consider him a contractor, and just like the variance, the contractor's held to a higher standard. And I truly believe it was supposed to be written that way.
Well, let's.
But it wasn't.
I mean,
right.
if
I mean,
we want to litigate
this
among ourselves.
We, yeah, no,
who's,
I mean,
who's
if we disagree, we disagree. It's
the,
okay.
The owner of the property is not an individual
you know, so.
Homeowner. It's a corporate. It's an LLC.
Right.
It's St. Cloud
so,
Realty
he's
Trust.
He's not a commercial,
so,
and he's not a
so it's not an individual
it's
homeowner, that's
it's
for sure.
It's a single family lot,
so,
though. It's one lot.
But it's
I
owned,
agree.
It's owned by a realty trust.
So,
it's a commercial
so anyway,
enterprise.
It's one lot.
I can tell I can tell I'm not the majority
phone
opinion,
wrestle.
Whatever.
That's kind of
a meeting. At this
well,
point, have we closed the
We did
hearing?
Say that we're going to let this thing ride for a few years and then
yes.
evaluate and make some adjustments,
yeah,
right? So maybe... This can be one of the adjustments we make when we get down the road a little bit.
Okay.
The meeting was closed.
The meeting was closed. I wanted to take a question about this project. Yes?
Yes, I have a question about this project.
Just
I'm
for the
John
sake.
Hall.
Cool. Thank you. Yeah.
I'm chairman of the Board of Selectmen and Ready. I will be the room. And I had a group of neighbors who this project. And so, you know,
I think it's fair that sometimes citizens trying to follow the bouncing ball in government is not an easy thing to do. I think you would probably all agree with that. This is such an example. So I guess the first question I have is, was there some expectation that the applicant would be here tonight?
No. No, because the meeting's closed.
Okay. Right. It's a public meeting.
Yeah.
Yes.
They're free to come.
They're free to come.
Okay. I'm just asking if there was an expectation that they would be here.
I didn't have that expectation, but I...
So, you know, the neighbors are very concerned because they're trying to understand what the disposition's going to be. So they're here. It sounds like there's been some back and forth with the applicant, and it sounds like that's unresolved at this time, although it seems like you guys have a plan for what you would like to have happen in your conditions. So I guess the biggest question is, at what point do you think that the neighbors and the, you know, surrounding this project will have some understanding from the Conservation Commission as to exactly how you guys will find and when it will flow out? And the reason for that is, I realize, and I think I've explained to them, that inside the purview of the Conservation Commission, there are things that you adjudicate. Those, then there will be probably in this project others that may find their way through the ZBA. They may find them their way through site planning, through permitting. Sounds like there's some open questions about deeds, you know. So there's a lot going on around this project. So I guess in the interest of the neighbors who have followed this rather diligently now for some months, as I understand, can you simplify for them what your expectations are in order to be able to move this down the conga line of the applicant's ultimate quest to put a shovel in the ground?
Do you want to take a stab at it?
We're about to issue an order of conditions on the project. We've had,
okay,
how many public hearings? Three? Well, four.
Yeah.
Three or four public hearings already. Chuck, our administrator, has a order of conditions drafted.
Good.
And what we're talking about now is whether or not to sign them. And I think the way the conversation was going, I think we're going to sign them. So that means you know, he has an appeal period, and after that he can pick up his order of conditions. And part of this orders of conditions is going to be that he resolve, the applicant resolve his issues with donating a conservation restriction, 4.1 acres of conservation,
right,
restriction, prior to receiving any building permits. So I think that's it. And that's the expectations in a nutshell.
So that's a plus. There were some other questions, I think, that some of the neighbors had. It sounds like maybe you guys have resolved in those conditions. Would a copy of those conditions be available for the neighbors to review at the same time? I would assume those are public records.
No, they're not. When we issue them, they can get a copy, but not before.
So, yeah, I do understand that, Chuck. So I guess that's really what I'm asking is, it sounds like from what Al has just mentioned that you guys are very close to issuing those. And so once they're issued, I just want to be sure that they'd be able to, you know, the neighbors would be able to get a copy.
Yeah.
I think that, you know, I think that there's been a lot happening with this lot, maybe for a long time, not just now, at other times. And I think the neighbors probably find themselves in a state of what's next, what's happening. They want to be confident that when all's said and done, if a single family home is going to go into their neighborhood and a nice family is going to move there, they want to be sure that everything follows the protocol. And they have some concerns about that, frankly. So,
well, that's unfortunate that they do have concerns, because all of the things we've been saying about this project, we've been saying at public hearings.
Well,
And we've addressed, you know, there's a situation going on in in town, and you know, you saw it in the earlier hearing where there's a, well, both previous hearings, that there's a big lot that somebody owns, and they're ready to, instead of it being just a one family nice big tree lot, that's a good solid buffer between between two streets, or that's making a really beautiful view in people's backyard. You know, people very well within their rights are buying these.
Absolutely.
And developing them, and there's no law that says they can't.
I totally agree with that. I think, you know, the neighbors do as well.
And, you know, and this is another situation that's going that way.
Well, this is not a subdivision.
No, but it's
taken down
treed,
all the trees.
It's a
this
treed
is
lot.
This is one house on a big lot leaving 92% of the trees in place.
Sure.
And giving a conservation restriction.
With a good percentage of the bulk area of the property going to permanent restriction and becoming public land.
One of the things that we're confronted with this type of project in the riverfront area, is the regulations say that a small house with a septic system and driveway has to be allowed. We can only craft how small it is, how far it moves away.
Right.
Yeah.
So we were always stuck with pretty much, unless it was a McMansion, allowing a house to go in there, or they would have denied, it would have gone to DEP, and they would have done a superseding
order. So don't confuse my question with, you know, some kind of a concern that the Conservation Commission has acted inappropriately. That's okay. That is the furthest thing from this. This is really simply trying to help a group of neighbors follow what sometimes is a long and winding road, because there's, you know, often more than one committee involved. And I think any issues that they have, at least the way I understand them, have nothing to do with your work.
Well, you know, I think this has been like watching sausage get made. It hasn't been pretty.
Yeah. I have that sense.
But what's really happened, sir, is the neighbors have had a number of opportunities to come speak publicly about this.
Yep.
With us, raise their concerns very, very thoroughly, very thoughtfully, with good reasons for doing it.
Yep.
We've had the consultants in front of us. We gave them a hard time. But they are within their rights to... Well, okay, well, I did. Totally within their rights to build on the lot.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean we can't have an argument about it when it happens. I talked to the DEP and made sure that we didn't end up in a situation where we refused to do something that was illegal and then it was going to get overturned. So we really did air all of this as publicly and as openly as we could. And... you know, we've been out there in our boots walking around in the river and in the mud. And as I said,
don't misinterpret
I say it for the neighbor's benefit, too, because I know it's been a really frustrating process for you guys. And it's your neighborhood, and you really don't want the trees to come down. We completely understand that. But at the same time, someone has an economic interest in that lot, and we've got a country that respects private property, and they own it. And so... what you got was the outcome that we have, and it's been in our attempt to balance all those competing interests, and at the end of the day, we end up with a 4-acre conservation restriction, we end up with a thoroughly vetted project with as many trees retained as possible, and as many protections for the environment and the Wetlands Protection Act requirements as we can get, and the builder, the owner of the property, gets to exercise their rights, and we all end up where we end up.
Any further questions? Yes.
Hi, Dave Rauchy.
Thank you.
17, I get it. And you know, I echo Mr. Halsey's, we've always been very respectful of you, and you know, there wasn't a reason why, you know, I reached out and had discussions with other people. It's the uncertainty that you know, we've all had, and the concerns and so forth. And you guys had, you know, said, and through my notes, and I've been taking diligent notes since day one, and it's always been the conflict, and you know, you can agree or not, or disagree, But in a lot of the presentations that Steve came up with and so forth about a river, starting off with a river, an intermittent stream, you know, gave us that, you know, that uncertainty. The false hope of what is going on here. It's been a river since 1816, you know, when it started. So the support that we, you know, we had in our neighborhood and so forth, we were like, okay. So we never ever said that we never wanted a house up there. You know, we welcome it. It has to be tastefully, has to be in, you know, all aspects of the word, you know, uniformed into our neighborhood and so forth. They're proposing 40 trees to come down. You know, we've always, you know, we've rehashed this. That is, you know, when we've tried to do something, the canopy. Rehashing what you said last week, you know, about the water. I've been watching it, you know, and I disagree with you. You closed the meeting last week, and you didn't have enough. You know, we wanted to say more, not you personally, but, you know, the chair. So, with all the aspects, you know, you're saying that 4.1 acres is going to be donated, or it's going to be.
It's going to be deeded.
Deeded.
To. Help me out. No.
No.
It's just a restriction on the deed. They still own the property.
They still own
the
easement, right?
Okay.
So,
like, right. Yeah, like
so we don't have to do that. All right. So then you brought up just recently about the issue of you know, the dwelling, the house. It looks to be like 29,000. I don't have the map in front of me. Excuse me.
2900.
And you talked about that previous meetings that the aesthetic of the neighborhood would probably not fit that. So what right do we have? And you know, you brought all these issues up in meetings and so forth. We've asked questions. We haven't got an answer.
So on that particular issue, our jurisdiction is limited to the Wetlands Protection Act and the Redwood Bylaws Protected. So the size of the house, you know, or the height of the house, or the color of the house, none of that really impacts the six critical factors that the Wetlands Protection Act outlines for protecting habitat, stormwater management, and the like.
So it's a balance between a house that, you know, this house is going to be for sale and someone needs to live there. So better answer to that question was what is the average size of houses that are being built today, and is 2,900 square feet excessive?
For that lot?
No. Well, the lot's 4 acres. I mean, you could look at it that way.
No.
Yeah, but you didn't.
No.
So,
okay. So that's all the here's the gray area. I mean, okay, so why don't we build a bigger one then?
Well, that's where the Wetlands Protection Act says you got to build the smallest house you can possibly fit. So he has to prove to us. So that house is only 2,900 square feet. All right, so they're building a lot of 33s and 4s these days. So it doesn't seem crazy. Now, I live in a lot smaller house, so to me this would be pretty big.
I do myself.
The yard that they're carving out for a yard isn't that big. There's only 10 feet of lawn in the back of this. So that's hardly enough to manage or paint the back of the house. You're standing on a ladder up there. So that's off the table. You can't make that lawn any smaller. We did talk about the porch area and the area that extends beyond the porch, and I got into the conversation with Steve, maybe that could be maintained as natural, but there's really no other spot. If it was a family that bought that house, they're not gonna play in the driveway all the time. They'd probably wanna have some lawn. So. For some lawn and for a deck, it just seemed reasonable. Now we were, I don't want to say warned, but we were, you know, it was written in the comments of the DEP that you know, is this as small as you can make it? And the applicant went back to DEP and explained, because there was some confusion about the garage and all that. It wasn't anything I just mentioned. But he said there's the bedrooms are going on top of the garage, and that's
pretty much what they needed to understand, because with that, they were using the same space to create two livable areas, garage and bedrooms. So they were solved. I have up there now all the trees getting down, but that, you know, is 2,200 square feet a big house? Is 1,800 square feet a big house? I'm not sure. You know, it's not about there's a number in the system for us to pull out and say, no, it has to be that. It has to do with the size of the property. It has to do with the, you know, how it fits on the lot.
But that's not conservation. That's...
Well, when I'm looking at size, I'm looking at what's around it. I mean, the people on the last one on Lowell Street.
Right.
I mean, that was a big house. They're jamming those in there. That's a typical cul-de-sac that happens. This is at least just one house with a lot of open space. Those are the trees that are being taken down. And just above that are the trees that are being replaced. So that's where I came up with 25 being replaced and 40 is actually a note on the plan. 40 trees are being taken down.
You can ask a sales question, but just one quick question about the tree.
Yeah.
Is that I didn't read and I don't have my sheet in front of me, but and you were gracious enough to give it to me, but the tree, I didn't see anywhere where it said 25 trees replaced.
15.
No, they mentioned 25 tonight.
Well,
so
it's so you know when we do things in this committee, we can count the trees that are there. So I know there's 40 in detail on the plan that says there's 40 trees coming out. But those ones right there that are highlighted, they're darker. Those are the ones that are going in, and then at the top of the plan, it tells you what they are, and it says, you know, what replaced proposed red maple,
arborvitae,
all of that. So we know from kind of knowing the plans and how they work that those are replacement trees. These are the trees that are going in to meet the replacement policy, and that's why I came up with 15. That are not going in.
15 trees are not going in.
Yeah. But that wasn't just, well, okay, I called Steve up, I asked him to explain what the difference is, why he thinks it's only $500, or that he owes us for the tree policy, or he's not going to put in the rest of the trees. He says that site can't support it. It's, with the shading, they're just going to die.
Where's your
Can I just say something?
I think we could look at it after they're planted and see, but I think there needs to be a lawn.
Going back to my original.
And I think they can't be too close to the house.
Right.
Chuck, excuse me, but it seems like we're kind of reopening a public meeting here. We have a gentleman that's been sitting here patiently since 7 o'clock tonight.
I understand.
I think.
Thank you, Dave.
Out of respect for this gentleman that's been waiting, I think we should get to him and. And if they want to come back to this, then maybe, you know, after, you know, the person that's been sitting here and it's on the agenda.
I would agree with Dave. I mean, we're getting into details, too. The applicant, the meeting was closed. The applicant has the right to be here if we talk about details. So if there's a discussion you want to have about the process, I think I'm open to that.
Yeah.
But I
agree. I don't want to get too mired in the details. I will entertain one last question if it's brief,
it is.
Then we will move on.
Sam, as you know, if I were
thank you.
Thank you, Nika. So two questions, right? One is around the trees here, these trees right here.
Okay.
Are those the three big oak trees that above my property?
Possibly, because if you look above, do you look above, see the turn in
so
road?
These are the new trees.
Right.
So they're taking all of those trees between our property?
No, they're only taking those two trees.
They're taking
these
two?
They can't take any other ones.
And they're planting five.
So that's fine. So they're going to leave, there's three oak trees here that are probably over 100 something years old.
Okay.
And I'm just going to ask this point blank on video. The Conservation Committee is okay with two trees over 100, probably 150 years old, being cut down?
Okay with it is not what we have to vote on. Okay with what we have to do.
Look,
is work with the applicant to create
either approve or deny their project based on the standards set forth.
But tonight we're approving it based on those two trees that are 100, probably 100, maybe I'm underestimating. And you,
no,
Anika, you've been
there's,
there.
There's a lot of trees that are really, really old, and the property owner is within his rights to take down those trees for the sake of this project. There's no law that says I can't cut down a 100-year-old tree,
but,
or that I can reject a project based on that 100-year-old tree.
But conservation can. I'm going
to
agree with you, but conservation can actually sit with the applicant and negotiate away from, negotiate those trees to basically stay as is and cut two other trees or move the driveways.
We can urge as much as possible. They are still within their rights to take those trees.
So let me ask you this question.
This is the last question I will entertain.
So let's move on from the trees. You've answered my question. The committee is allowing it to happen. So water, runoff. Last time we talked about it never was closed. And I think sewage is in your preview, correct? Water runoff?
Stormwater management is part of our permit review, yes.
Correct. For a house of 20, and this goes back to the conversation that Mr. Rauchy was alluding to with the size of the home.
Yeah.
With the size of the home being 2,900 square feet.
Yep.
There was a proposal for putting in a 1,000-gallon tank.
Okay.
And Mr. Fitch, I think it was Mr. Fitch, who was on the conservation committee, said a house that size, and he was on the committee, basically should have at least a 5,000-gallon tank.
Okay. If I can't...
Anika, I don't think you were here for that meeting.
Well, these plans, some people on conservation are engineers and have looked at those tank specs. That tank is...
That plan has a stamp on it.
Right.
And a professional engineer designed this plan. That is designed to infiltrate the roof runoff, and it's designed according to a specific design storm, because there's a variety of different rain events that could happen. There could be a 24-hour, 2-inch storm. There could be, you know, so there's all these variables that go into the design of the sizing of that. But I have high confidence that based on the design of that and on the surrounding material, that is going to function
so
as it's designed.
What was actually stamped, as Al said? What's
the
size
entire...
of the... No, what was the size of the tank that was...
1,000.
It's 1,000-gallon.
The bare minimum.
1,000-gallon dry well. So it's 100% dry.
It's a bare minimum.
So...
Where are the
okay.
bare minimums? Well, I don't understand why you're saying that, bare minimum.
Well, I'm gonna move on.
I think we can overlook it. Move on.
I don't know if we're.
But I would offer one thing. And looking at the plan here, if you really like this tree, it almost seems like an accommodation could be made for one of those two trees, and maybe we should look at that again. I'm not saying not saying to keep this open, but I could ask again.
So I mean, it surprises me you say that, because when I put my addition on 14 years ago, conservation gave me the worst treatment ever for 2 feet that I wanted to go beyond. And then they didn't allow me to cut the tree in the driveway, which is the same size tree. So don't say in the driveway. It's in the middle of my driveway, Anika. So don't bring
Mr.
back.
Magazoo, I understand
in the driveway.
Some grief
no.
and some complaints with conservation. I hear you loud and clear.
It's the comment you made.
I'd like to move on with this matter tonight. We're going to do that. We're within our rights to do that. I understand you're upset. I'm sorry.
Thank you, Chuck, for at least bringing that up. If you could do that, Chuck.
I would like to entertain a motion if on behalf of the order of conditions for this matter.
So let's go over the what we're going to add to the order of conditions and then make a motion. So we're going to add, I'm going to be allowed to add the language for the CR.
You have to add that.
I'm going
to
ask about the tree. And did I forget anything? Was there anything else?
The $500, do you need to clarify that?
Yeah, where are we at with that? the tree policy, the runoff, actually, the, we don't have to get into it, the runoff. If the $500 is acceptable, then that was the third one.
Mm-hmm. Okay, all those in favor of a $500 fee for the replacement of, as a donation towards the tree fund, the replacement of the trees that are not going to get planted?
Can you,
I need a motion to that.
That was me making a motion, I'm sorry.
I want someone to request that I talk to the applicant, just to make it more efficient.
Chuck, could you talk to the applicant about
the two trees in the drive?
Two trees?
Yeah. I will.
I'll second Anika's motion.
Well, I don't think the motion will, did you make a motion to approve the issuing an order of condition?
No, to agree to the $500 limit. That was the motion.
Okay.
And there's a second, all those in favor? Opposed? Okay.
I'm not in love with this.
Abstain, so it's 2-3.
Who seconded?
Al. Okay, so, at this point, that's, so how are we going to resolve that then?
So are we debating whether they should give us $3,700 or $500?
I think there's a number that can be lower that's in between, but I think.
Was it just 3-2?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was.
Said no.
We need quorum. I mean, you need a minimum quorum.
It's not a majority vote, it's a quorum.
So we don't have the number.
That's
quorum.
Right.
Yeah. So we have the majority.
So, Mike, what do you propose, or do you
propose,
have a?
I would propose somewhere about 1,000 to 1,500. To me, I think there's a lot being taken out. It's not being replaced. I think the conservation restriction is not, it's not just about the trees. I think there's a lot of other things that are going on the site that's closing. And to be honest, it's a conservation restriction on a river.
Great. I think there's positives and like it's not completely filling me up with it. So I think
you weren't here at the last meeting. Then
I wasn't.
Do you
know so added five
with the Longwood Conservation Area?
I saw the communications through.
We also added five wood duck nesting boxes that they were going to place in there as well.
Yeah.
So
at their own cost.
At their cost.
Well, what's a wood duck nesting box cost?
It's an
wood
duck
nesting
cost. I think that'd be $1,000.
I don't know what
the. That's what the scouts are paying for bat boxes.
Yeah. All right. So they're putting five in.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. So I was.
So now you want to change your vote?
Yeah. You know, well, so I didn't want to vote without being informed about what.
Yeah, that's okay. You weren't here.
Yes.
Yeah. So are you on the
so it was how much per tree? We've said 250. 250 a tree. 1,000.
I think you can ask for it. I just don't think with the way the tree policy is written, I don't think
you
can demand it.
Yeah, we can't
enforce them. I mean, that's you know.
Chuck, where are we within our time limit of signing this order of conditions right now?
We need to sign by Wednesday. And as a matter of fact, I'd have to send it out on Wednesday. It's the issued on Wednesday, and that's...
So
in lieu of the additional mitigation you guys have brought to my attention...
that's next Wednesday. I was talking about next
Wednesday. Make a motion for the $500.
Right.
I'll second.
All those in favor? Opposed? Okay.
Okay, my God.
Okay, so conservation restriction language is all set. The tree limit donation to the tree fund, that's clarified. Any other comments on the order of conditions? I don't have any other comments on the order.
I saw the word two that was spelled.
That
number
was,
two. Right,
we'll
w.
Do a, we'll
that was fixed.
Okay.
Editor in chief.
All right.
So I added a clause in the we were I sent back just to Chuck, requiring they clean up all the trash out in the river area.
Okay, good.
The barrel, plastic junk, the leaf debris that's been dug.
All the stuff you brought up during the
session.
Okay.
That's in the bill.
Okay.
Can I make an amendment to that amendment, what you just said? I would agree with anything that's out in the middle of the swamp, but I don't agree that the property owner should be made to clean up anything that's in the backyard of any of those houses that are along Arcadia or Arnold.
Well, it's on their it has to be on their property.
Yeah. We don't want to clean up anything that's not on his property.
Just on the...
It may not be.
So,
you know, there might be areas in the houses
that
are behind
Arcadia.
They're
never going to interpret my request that they clean up their property to mean cleaning up someone else's property.
What I'm saying is that someone from that house...
Steve said that was okay at the last meeting. He agreed to it.
Okay, are you satisfied with that? All right, are we moving on? Is there any other comments about the order of conditions? Okay, hearing none, is there a motion to approve the order of conditions?
I make a motion to approve the order of conditions as amended.
As discussed and drafted tonight. Okay.
As discussed and drafted tonight.
And seconded by Dave, all those in favor?
There's no drafting.
Opposed? None. Okay, motion passes. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Where do we go from here?
Second, Dave.
This is going to get issued.
Yeah.
There's an appeal.
You seconded.
There's an appeal period.
For the applicants.
No.
Go ahead.
You can appeal after we issue it, and you have 10 days to appeal. And you just go to the DEP website. And you have to base it on something. You know, the commission didn't look closely enough at the reduction of the size of the house or something like that, or some of the trees could have been saved and it was overlooked. Those are two good things. And then I think you can download that. I'm not sure it costs any money. It might cost $25. So it's on the TV website. You can call me if you can't find it.
There's a time period that you have to do it, right?
Yeah, 10 days.
Okay.
So when is the order?
This order will not be issued until at least Monday, if not Tuesday.
Of next week.
Of next week, yeah.
That will be on your website?
No. No. We don't usually post the orders. We don't do that here. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Thank you for coming out. Thank you. Okay. Thank you for waiting so long.
Good evening.
Good evening.
John Larusso, Vice President of the Reading Rifle.
Yes.
As you all know. And
I know how John feels. I've been the last man standing at these meetings 30 times, haven't I, Anika?
Yeah.
Chuck has got to be on purpose for about 3 years.
We got a new rule that
wait
that
till you come back,
have
man.
To also be done in Latin.
I don't know if you've earned the penultimate spot yet, but you won't be last.
I have to learn them a long time ago. I've been hot into my cold.
So,
so if I think slow and talk worse, it's I got a reason.
You're in good company.
Yeah.
Fun. So there's a draft order of conditions for this project. People look at it.
I read it. I had no changes.
No change. Me too. Any comments or changes?
I didn't have a chance to read it. I wasn't really yet.
Let's hold on a second. Let's
okay.
Not move too quickly. I'm still working on this. You guys need to sign this here. And then I need to look at my folder, my notes.
Artists just continue. Nobody's here.
Yeah.
I said 4 or 5, probably like 11.
So, John, one of the things that we're going to ask you to do in this order of conditions was to put in granite bounds on the 25-foot line. But there may, I mean, you know, like, I'm thinking ricochet. Is that going to be a problem with, yeah, right? Yeah. Isn't it?
Could we put it on the back side of the structures, though?
We could, but then when you, well...
How far will they go? I mean, it's just
supposed to be 25 foot
It's just where we work, maybe you have the map.
What if we, what if we hung them with a wire on the, what's the barrier called?
So that people can shoot them?
Berm. Haskell block.
Haskell block. So.
Well, they'll be on the line for the most part.
Right, so the Haskell barriers are on the line.
Yeah.
So if you're leaving the building and you've got the barrier on the left, what if we just hung it right on there? Outside of shooting range.
Well,
then.
That's outside.
I mean, you got
outside,
a 9 foot. You got
yeah,
a 9 foot
yeah,
wall.
Well, here this is the building.
Yeah.
Right.
And this is the 25 foot area.
So
yeah.
where's the
is.
Barrier on there?
Well, this is the barrier. This
is the outside area.
The
shooting area.
It's here on the Haskell blocks.
So when things settle
this
in,
is the building here.
Right. So when things settle in, you're not going to be able to walk back here, right?
This
no one's going to go there.
There's
so
no reason.
Just hang a tag there and call it good.
Okay.
Do you guys agree?
Like on the outside of the wall?
Yeah. Right
yeah.
Here.
I'm fine with that, putting it on the outside
yeah.
of the wall.
And what do I do here and here? Do I do the same?
No one's going to see
say,
so you
can
put one here?
Yes.
Okay.
So that people going that way and people
yeah.
going this way understand that everything back there is conservation
restricted? What are they
restricted?
Doing? What can they do or not doing that? Can they walk on it?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Like a walkout?
It's the same
sure.
It's the same thing that you have to do here. It's we take the opportunity to now make it more noticeable that it's
carry your standard.
Treat the same as you've always
here.
Done. Yeah.
Yeah.
You're just not
going to
be able to.
Yeah, well, this is a gravel top.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
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 No, absolutely. It gives us the opportunity.
Over here, we got, you know, the bushes and whatnot.
I don't think we would necessarily propose to put any, I mean.
Just here and here.
Can we amend those signs so that they say conservation restriction? If you go on beyond this point, you'll be shot.
Well, if they do, this is a trap range over here.
It's
possible. That's.
Don't have me scared. This isn't a conservation restriction. Conservation area.
I think on those two corners is great.
Common sense
yeah,
is always applied.
Yeah.
And I just wanted to ask the commission if they looked at the plant placement policy and if you're satisfied with that.
I was satisfied with that.
And you are, as the rifle club, are going to be asked to submit a report to the commission, basically just like the first round we had with Lowell Street. Stating that there is an 80% survival rate
okay.
on those plants.
Oh, whatever it is, 100, whatever it is.
I hope so, but it's for 2 years, and you have Mark right there, so.
And we're supposed to replace it once a day.
Yeah, usually what ends up happening is until you get your order of conditions, which would be at the end of this project, you have to replace any plant that dies. And outside of that, you have to have an 80% survival rate. So if one or two die,
you're
within that.
Okay.
So it's up to you, and as things grow in, it's not so much. That's all I have.
You're going to have to hang the conservation signs on the other side of the Haskell barrier to the right as well?
Yep. Far, two of them.
The far side, maybe one
east,
in the corner.
East corner or the west corner?
Here,
mm-hmm.
here.
Yeah.
To the right.
This guy?
Yeah.
Well, people will walk here.
Right, but that's inside the conservation area.
So the water over here?
Yeah.
Okay. We don't do
maybe,
anything.
Maybe there, or, I don't know, halfway up. I understand that, but that's also
they
much marking. Yeah.
I wouldn't be able to see this anyway.
Yeah.
Because this is big.
Yep.
Especially in the summer.
I mean, the only place that
well, can you,
I would say...
Barrier, you could just, like, pop a hole in that. They're 10,
yeah,
and you could just, like, wire it to it or something like that.
Yeah, it's a wire.
So we provide those,
yeah,
so two
on.
More is not going to be a big
no,
problem.
No problem.
Okay, any other comments?
Nope.
Questions?
Can I?
Yeah?
I had a couple of questions. And
go ahead.
And they were under the... Okay, bear me out. Under the list of special conditions, page 15.
Yep.
One was on paragraph 2, if I'm reading this right, and some of the work I used to do in the past, and a lot of legal stuff. Prior to commencing any work on the site, the applicant shall obtain all of the permits. So before we break ground, we should get a permit from the building department?
I don't know what the building department requires.
Yeah, but
yeah.
I'm not
so.
Doing any building. So when I make the overhang, the porch roof, or the back of the clubhouse, that's when I should get the building permit.
You're gonna be digging for it.
Eventually, but first I have to grub the whole area, then I have to put up the walls, because over there on the side, there's the scope of work and there's the order of work.
You know what, it'd probably save you a lot of headaches to go and spend 5 minutes and just ask Glenn.
Well, I did ask him, I did. So on the overhang on the back of the building, that would be needed. It was very questionable on the bullet barriers.
Okay.
So that's another story. So I'd like to put the cart before the horse, not put the cart before the horse, and say, until I come to that point, then I get a permit for that work. Whether it's construction, putting the roof on, or doing anything with the bullet barriers. So could that be amended to, prior to commencing any work on the site, which may need permitting, the applicant shall obtain all other permits. That makes sense to me.
Just conditioning the first.
I heard different from Glenn. I'm not sure. He said
that's my exact words.
I'm always going to side with what I heard from Glenn. So mm-hmm. what he said was maybe the HESCO barrier. What are those? The shading doesn't have to be.
Yeah, the bullet deflectors.
But the footings absolutely have to be.
Okay.
So that you're going to do the footings before that is.
So right? Shouldn't I get a permit when I do that?
So what are the first steps you're going to take? You're going to build.
I'm going to follow the plan of work, which is on which I can't see. It needs to be blown up.
The construction sequence, you mean?
Yes, the construction sequence.
So one of the things that
we're going to follow that
we try to avoid with this is things getting half done, and all of a sudden sitting in a state of flux.
That's not going to happen. They can't help.
Most people that come in, you know, they come in because they want to get something done.
Yes.
So it's, you know, I'm usually of the opinion, you know, if you've got a timeline that you've got set, and I'm certainly open to hear that, you know, I'm usually of the opinion that you want to get it all at once.
So this comes down to number 9 in the process, with the deflector shields. And 5 is the firing line roof.
So what's the timeline between those?
I don't know.
You certainly can do 1 through 4
yeah.
under our permit.
Yeah. And then when it comes time to do that,
with the
I don't have a problem. Really
concrete retaining wall.
That's the rear of the impact area. That's.
I would just need to hear from Glenn that would be okay. I mean, I could simply just give him this list. I'm not sure he even has looked at your plan yet, and say. What would he allow? But I, you know, 1 through 4 is fine as long as Mark goes out there and gets your limit of work in place and you put your erosion control. That's always first. And you can take down the trees. That's also fine. You can clear everything out. That's fine. Right. You can grade with that erosion control up.
Right.
But when you're constructing the wall,
yeah.
if Glenn doesn't need to look at that,
that's not a building.
See, we're just getting into like the weeds by talking what can you do and what can't you do. That's why we just simply say that you need to get a permit and let Glenn hash out what he wants to be involved with or not. And then once we know that's in place, you know, you can go and do whatever you want. But you can certainly do 1 through 4.
Okay. Hold on. I need a drink of water. Cough medicine's a wonderful thing to dry you out. I just didn't want that to be an impediment before I broke ground and turned one spade.
Right. I think as long as we've got some sort of okay from the building department, I'd be fine with that. Well, I guess what I wouldn't want to see is you do 1 through 4 and then you go to the building department and they say, well, something has to change. And now you've grubbed and you've graded and you've done things in an area that wouldn't necessarily
get. Because he was concerned about the only thing that we originally had concerns about, which was the overhang, the wooden structure, the kind of the roof line, which was to be in the back of the building,
okay.
which does need a permit, and the bullet barriers, which I guess someone's saying needs footings and so forth. But I didn't hear anything about the cement blocks that were going to be put in the impact area. I didn't know they were part of the building.
They're fairly high, so he might want to look at the detail on that. It's a concrete wall that's standing up. So
are we talking about the HESCO barriers?
No, it's at the back side of the firing range. It's at the very
But we're not the building department.
I got it. Okay. All right. And number four, over here, a list of special conditions. It's I already have a detailed construction sequence, so I don't think I need to make another one. Can I strike that?
No.
Some of this is just boilerplate. We just keep in.
You might make changes, and if it's just there, well, if you made a change,
right.
We can just say that you're supposed to submit a plan before this change.
All right.
Okay.
All right. May I trouble you for one or two more things? It's on page 19. List of additional conditions. Do I have to change the deed for the plot?
Page numbers. You don't have to.
That's A2? Or is that only on sale? Which we're never going to sell the club.
We ask you to record this against your deed.
Against it.
That's all you have to do.
To record it. Okay, yeah. This was something new to me. I didn't know that was necessary. I didn't do it 3 years ago. I did the 300 and the 500 yet.
Yeah, when Nancy Eaton did the swap for one land for the other, that was written up. That was recorded. I think
that was decades.
Yeah.
But when I did other work on the 300 and 500 yard line, I didn't have to.
We didn't use this type of permit.
We didn't. Okay.
That was more moving around dirt.
Okay.
This is a structure.
Okay. All right. So there's a difference. So I didn't know if that was a common practice, because I thought it wasn't requested at the time any other work.
That ensures that if you ever sold the property, which you're not going to.
Yes, so that's what it's really for?
That what we've decided here, the conditions we put on the property survive the transfer of the property.
All right, so do I have to file this, or is this done when and if the property is ever sold?
No, you do it now.
I do it now?
You have to file. That's also in the special conditions for the Wetlands Protection Act.
So that's in the regulations?
That's in the regular regulations. We're just seconding it. So both asked for it to be recorded, and as a matter of fact, the paperwork to do that is in that first half.
Yeah, it's right in it, right?
So,
I didn't know anything.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Yeah.
So they asked you to do it. So, what you're doing is
you're
just giving
us course on all this.
You're just giving us a little more ability to oversee your project and have some, pressure.
You mean we should be charging you for this education?
This could be a satellite course.
Well, let's get to his last question.
Yeah,
that's probably
what
we're charging.
What else did I have? And this was on number 19. It says number 19 on page 17. It says riverfront area. Is this? I don't think this is riverfront.
That was struck out.
Take him out. Omit that.
That was when I was working on
Arcadia. Yeah. Now, my main question.
Yeah, we didn't get that. We didn't get that in our version.
My main question, which is the last page 20. There's a bond of $21,000 that's needed or requested. Is this necessary? Why is this necessary?
This is typically requested when there's a significant amount of work that's going to be done, and it's just a surety. It's like a performance surety to, if the plants are destroyed or eaten or die from drought or whatever, that this bond covers the replacement cost.
But this is seven times the cost if I had to buy every tree I cut.
How did we come up with the 21?
Yeah,
this is seven times.
Yeah, I don't know where the 21,000 came from.
How many trees are you replacing? It was like 21 trees times 250 or something like that.
Yeah. And I'm doing extra.
I don't think 21,000 is
the
right
amount. No, wait a minute. It was
25 trees.
But it was certainly. And I'm sorry, I think I told Mark when we were talking on the phone.
What?
But I said I left it in there high, but I wrote to be
determined
after
it,
just
that.
So people noticed it. I didn't want to have it just left there.
Right.
So
well, we noticed it.
There you go. So it worked.
At 60, if I bought the 25 trees, it would have been $250 a tree. That was $6,250.
So I'm not so sure that the
we can do something.
This surety bond was originally put in place to maintain the trees. It's,
that was my understanding.
Well, usually the surety bond is used to when the project dies in the middle and it's an eroded site. It's for the commission to come back and put it back together. It has nothing to do with planting because usually it'll just put some hydro seed on there. So, and again, I apologize for doing that shocker. I was more shocked when I thought Anika was about to say, yeah, we need it. But, so it's really to stabilize the site.
And I'm
still let you say that.
And so that's the number you need to come up with. So,
I think $2,500 is fine.
Now, may I argue my point for my club? One, we're a 501c7. This isn't a money-making operation. We're not doing this like the others. We're going to sell a house. We're going to make a development or anything of that nature. We're not for profit. And also, I have a bit of a track record with this board, as you, some of you all well know. You know, 3 years ago with the other projects we did exactly what we said we'd do.
Yep.
You know, we didn't pull any shenanigans.
So you know we don't keep the money. We give it back to you when you're done.
Okay, but meanwhile we have to take it out and put it aside and all that.
So what
and
would
there's provision A4 we can hold 10%.
What would be a good number for you?
Well, hold on. We've exceeded the tree policy by 20 shrubs and bushes. So we didn't just do exactly what we have to. We threw 20 more.
So, but to Chuck's point,
we went over.
The idea is,
I mean, we're being a good, good steward of the land.
I'm trying to put it to you. The issue is if for some reason, you get the whole site rubbed out.
Yeah.
And one of your treasurer runs off with all your money and goes to Mexico.
Well, that's
and you can't finish the project. That's the sort of thing that the surety bond is intended to protect,
so
the project can't get completed.
It's unlikely to happen because, like, the gun clubs.
Oh, it is.
I actually really feel bad that I put this in there now, because the gun
clubs
is almost like a brotherhood, where in a sisterhood, where the people out there, you have equipment on site, right? And they have people to operate the equipment. The consultant. Yeah,
make a motion.
I make a motion to strike the surety.
Is there a second?
I don't know. That was
okay. All those in favor? Okay.
Thank you. That's my main question. That's all I got.
Yeah, sorry, John, man.
I'm fine.
I'm glad he at least got you nervous.
That's why
you were sticking around so long.
That's what our kids do.
That's the only reason they get homework.
I will second that, Dave.
I don't know what I'm voting for.
You're
to sign
the order of conditions. Okay.
Thanks.
Yep. And it was seconded by
things get
Al. Is it? They do. We start to get a little. Yeah. Okay.
Right.
Do you have any other questions, or?
How long does the full last?
Hopefully.
Yeah, they had
2 minutes. Hopefully, you know. I don't know.
By the way, Mr. Russo, there's no charge for the entertainment that you had to watch tonight.
Yeah. You guys put up with a lot.
12:15 last night.
Yeah.
It's rough. Everyone's hair
but
starts to look a little different.
We thought we were going to be done at 9. No question of expectations.
Okay.
I liked the 3 minutes.
One hour.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hours,
yeah.
I might
see you, John.
You're welcome to stay, but
just
you're also
sure
free to go.
Thank you.
Okay.
You can come down and pick this up, or you can.
All right, I don't think there's 110 Main Street artists, nothing going on with that.
Yeah.
No bills.
No bills. The minutes are not prepared.
I am going to do the same thing the last week. Oh, they're not prepared?
They're not prepared.
I'm going to make a motion to accept them all.
Read this and then give back to
me. We never even thought of that. So at this point, unless Chuck has anything else or anybody has anything else, it's a motion to adjourn. Go ahead.
I think the last two meetings,
we
need to be careful about closing and
doing anything beyond that.
Discussion back up.
And,
yeah.
We went down the rabbit times.
Yeah. I know.
Yeah.
And we did something similar with the property with the.
He saw him, but he didn't get it. He didn't hear from you guys.
The call.
I'm not sure that
call.
He's even paying attention to. He wants
but
to look at
the thing
plans.
Is that
did you guys drop something off?
We were led
probably
to.
Not, right? Because you're not looking for your
the selectmen.
No.
To answer a question as to what happens from here.
Yeah, I think he wants to.
And that didn't imbue that they were going
to
reopen and rehash everything that they had already passed before. You know, it's like, well, wait a minute, you know.
I think it's okay to talk about the process. I just think we need to be careful about opening the conversation.
But when it comes right down to it.
Yes.
And they got some admissions. They got in their order that he's going to ask about trees without the applicant.
You're right. And, you know, that was one of the things I was sitting there saying is I hope we don't make any decisions. And I'm the one that said that. And because I completely forgot. we weren't supposed to let that influence the decision. The applicant, you know, has the right to be there for something like that.
And we already closed.
We need to be careful if we're closing something.
I mean, I realize
he's going to go ask for.
They say no, they say no. I mean,
but you're right.
I realize these things are emotional, but we're going to draw the line. I mean, we're gonna, this is a public hearing.
It doesn't have to be emotional. It really doesn't.
Oh, it's emotional for them.
I know, but it's always.
One of the things you have to look at with this is that these people went through a long process with this, and they were fearful about what was going to happen. But, you know, in the end result, you know, they're not going to be dealing with the developer, they're not going to be dealing with the person. They might be another family that's just as nice as they are that moves in that house and they become best of friends and everything else, and this is all going to be for naught.
I think what we should do is when we know we're going to have a controversial application, in the beginning, we should explain. You guys might have to come to 10 or 12 meetings. In all likelihood, there's only been one or two applicants that have been denied by this board in the last five or 8 years. In all likelihood, if these people follow the rules, they're going to be approved. So, you know, you can't stand up and say you used to swim there or skate there or you got water in your base. None of those things are going to be pertinent. So we'll listen to you, explain them in advance, and then maybe they won't waste their time to get all pissed off at us coming to five meetings thinking they're going to get the thing stopped.
Well, I think you got to be careful with that you don't make it look like we've already made up our minds.
Yeah.
Well,
it's not even that.
I know what you're saying.
Yeah, it's not that we've made up our minds. We can say if they comply with the rules, they're going to be approved.
Did you hear what Mr. Magusa said? It was the fact that he had another dealing with a conservation, with this town's conservation commission that, what do you say, he had to leave a
tree
in his
driveway.
It's the inconsistency historically, and he's got enough history to...
Well, that's true, but you can understand where he's coming from.
There's a very, very simple answer to that question. We just established our new tree policy last August, so the tree policy has changed.
Right.
Shuts them up right away.
So I agree.
No, it's...
So let me ask it another way.
Can we deal with Lipton Farm?
Can we say when we open a meeting on a topic like this that now we're going to allow... I don't know how you do this, but you allow 20 minutes of questions.
I've been to boards where the chair says, each person's got 3 minutes, and if I deem it to be repetitive, then I'm going to ask you to sit. Because if you have new information, the board wants to hear it. But I'm not going to allow 15 people to stand up and say the same thing.
Right.
Right.
And it has to be relevant to...
People get off in the weeds, and we haven't had it too much. We haven't had a real late meeting in a while, but... occasionally the controversial ones come in, and they got to be worked out.
So, but I think if we set some expectations.
Yeah, we've been out pretty early a lot.
Yeah. The last month or two has been relatively.
They broke ground at that Hall project yet?
No. They asked me about erosion control.
What's the Hall project?
Oh,
extension of the whatever road
Random
it is.
I was thinking of that one. I was thinking of the one where we brought the guy back in. That he was going to appeal.
Oh, Carol. 44 Roma Lane.
Yeah.
That was one where we closed.
Can we close the meeting?
Yeah,
well, there's no more. There's no minutes. There's no more business, Chuck.
You might want to go through those, just for the record.
No,
minutes for approval, August 24.
I didn't. Those aren't prepared. I'll send those
September
out.
September 14,
yeah.
February 8. None. Move to the next meeting. Okay. I don't see anything else.
Any other
agenda.
Questions? Anybody in the audience?
Make a motion to adjourn.
I'll second.
Those in favor? Okay.
Thank you.
So, you know.